gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barndominium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chief Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure! Penny just dives in!
Bradford.
All right, greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home inside the Gamecocks, the show live from the Signarama Studios, the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks, signarama.com. They're the preferred sign partner for a reason. They do the best work. They are Gamecock owned and operated and everything in between. Matt Vaughn is the owner. He's the operator. He's a big-time Gamecock fan as well. Signarama.com in West Columbia. Built by the Barndo Co. The Barndominium Co. is turning heads left and right. They're one of the nation's best builders. They've got a brand-new office up in Dunn, North Carolina as well. They are expanding rapidly. Anywhere in the Carolinas, Georgia, or in Tennessee, you could own your dream home and build it with the Barndominium Company. Of course, always served by chicken, cock, bourbon. It tastes good 7 days a week, as we all well know. We'd love to have Hale McGranahan 7 days a week. He is a busy, busy man. The portal is open. The spring game is upon us. Recruiting is on fire. And he joins us now to lead off our Tuesday program. Mad Dog, myself, JC, will be in just a moment. By the way, Alex Jones will join us after Shane Beamer's press conference this afternoon to recap everything that he had to say. Hey, Hale.
What's up?
Well, it sure has picked up for you in the last, I don't know what, 4 or 5 days, right? The recruits are committing, and there's news on guys who aren't. The portal's open. The spring game's here. Pretty crazy.
I mean, it started last Wednesday when I was on with you guys to close out that episode of the show, and it was Brian Rowe who committed that afternoon. Yeah. And started this little run that Carolina's on right now with Four welcome homes from Shane Beamer, with one to be revealed at a date later on from now. But yeah, things have picked up, and like we've been trying to tell folks would eventually happen, just needed to try to exercise a little bit of patience, and here we are. Things are starting to rock and roll, and they've got some pretty good players in the class already.
And it's getting warmer this week as well. As we know, summer, of course, naturally, it's going to be only 68 degrees as we tee off for the Big Spur Golf Tournament next Monday. But that'll still be nice. All right, Hale. So yesterday, the news began to kind of get out that it looks like the top quarterback target for South Carolina in 2025 may be headed elsewhere. Could you fill us in on what you know there?
Yeah, Ryan Montgomery, who is announcing his commitment tomorrow, is all indications are that it's going to be Georgia, which is something that I tried to talk about as often as I could as far as Georgia's involvement with him and what that might mean for South Carolina. And I like to think I spelled it out kind of clearly that I had concerns that Georgia was being kept in the thing all along. They kept getting a seat at the table. They were just lingering. And Here we are. The decision, again, it'll be announced tomorrow, but I know I'm not the only person in the industry that I work in who's surprised that it's gotten to this point that it's looking like Georgia, because they've been trying to flip Julian Lewis, who's from the state of Georgia, Carrollton, who's committed to Southern Cal. They ran on the Matt Zoller's kid, who committed to Missouri a couple weeks ago. And I think, again, I know that a lot of people just weren't really sure if Ryan Montgomery was going to be a take for Georgia at any point. And whenever that shifted, whether it was a couple weeks ago or 3 days ago, whatever the case may be, they clearly are ready to take his commitment and bring him in the class. And, you know, they offered him more than a year before South Carolina did. They've been on him for quite some time, and I'm pretty sure he visited Athens a couple times before he even had an offer from the Gamecocks. So they've had a seat at the table really since the start with this guy, and he's encouraged them to keep pulling up a chair all throughout the process.
Do you think if that commitment becomes a reality, when is he committing, Hale?
Tomorrow.
Okay. If that becomes a reality, is that it? Or do you believe the Gamecocks will continue to recruit him?
I would imagine that'll be it.
Okay.
I'll get the sense that he's going to be the type to flip at some point. One thing I picked up yesterday, that Georgia has tried to prioritize in recruiting, not just the quarterback, but across the board, is they want to do their best to get guys who they think are going to commit, sign, and ultimately stay at Georgia once they're there and not transfer. And I think they've sort of pegged Ryan Montgomery as that type of guy. And just based on my interaction with him and the family, I would think they'll probably be loyal to that as long as they can.
This isn't really a question for you because you don't cover Georgia. I guess I need to probably go check it myself, and I haven't had a chance to do it this morning, but it feels like Georgia's got a roster full of quarterbacks over there. You know, of course, this is 25. I get it. You know, Carson Beck will be moved on. Brock Vandergriff has moved on. That's kind of the name of the game now, though, right, Hale? I mean, you have to continue to recruit over yourself and may the best man win and just expect you're going to lose guys to the portal. Whatever happened to Gunnar Stockton? He's still on the roster, isn't he?
Yeah, he's their backup now. And there's probably a better than good chance that he's going to play a lot this fall, because I would guess that Georgia's probably going to beat up on some folks and give him an opportunity to play a lot of snaps. So he's, from what I understand, he's their number two right now. Not a bad spot to be either. Gunnar Stockton, because if you're the number two this year, then conceivably you have the leg up on the race in 2025.
Yeah, and I'd say hats off to Gunnar Stockton too for sticking it out. As we all, he was a very highly recruited quarterback, as we all know. And generally, these guys go somewhere they want to play, and then they don't. I mean, he's been there now. This has got to be his fourth year in the program, right?
No, he was a class of 22 coming out of high school, so he's
third year.
Yeah, third year.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking back to when he committed. Because he committed in 21, didn't he?
He committed to Carolina in 2020. And
2020,
stayed,
that's right.
Yeah, stayed committed throughout the change there and sort of gave Beamer a shot and then decommitted and committed to Georgia in 21, like you said. So
okay, yeah. So I had his class wrong. That's right. He was an earlier guy. Well, hats off to him. Hats off to him, because most guys don't do that, and he's still there. Brock Vandergriff, of course, has moved on to Kentucky. We'll see what the fall looks like for him. All right, so what do you know about where South Carolina goes from here as far as recruiting this position in 2025?
Not a whole lot. Trying to figure that out as we speak. There's been a lot of talk, of course, over the last 10, 11 months, how Montgomery was the guy that Dow Loggins was going after, and I guess there are probably some contingencies that Loggins has in mind, but I don't know. And I, if there are, I don't know who they are. They offered a few different guys the same day when they offered Montgomery last May. One of them who was Deuce Knight, who's from Mississippi, committed to Notre Dame. The other, Will Wilson from Richland Northeast, who committed to NC State about a month after getting the offer. I don't think that Deuce Knight is going to flip from Notre Dame to South Carolina. He's left the door open for some folks, but I don't get the sense that South Carolina is one of them. I'm not sure if South Carolina is going to try to re-engage with Will Wilson. He seems pretty locked in with NC State. Another guy, in-state quarterback, Cutter Woods from Westside High School in Anderson, came to camp last summer, visited for the Clemson game in the fall, and Loggins certainly liked him and had his eye on him, but he committed to Wake Forest less than a week ago. So we shall see. I mean, A.J. Brand from Irmo, who plays quarterback at Irmo and has some offers to play quarterback at other places, has been recruited to Carolina as more of an athlete safety type of guy, and I don't think that's going to change around here. So whether it's a high school guy or portal guy down the road or a combination of the two, we shall see. But you know, I'm not sitting here trying to paint this like it's a positive, not by any means, because this is clearly who Dow Loggins wanted to get. But it's not the end of the world because, again, there's the transfer portal as an option down the road. And, you know, if 6 months from now, 7 months from now, if South Carolina is struggling to get a transfer quarterback, it's probably because Lawrence Sellers just played his ass off and had a great season and is the guy. So lots to figure out and plenty of time to do it. So I don't think anyone should be panicking too much right now.
Yeah, I'm not at all. It is also interesting. It's not like this position, not that you want to lose a top tier quarterback. When you're going after your guy, you want to land your guy. That's how you build depth. I get it. I'm not trying to minimize the situation either. I totally understand. If there's a silver lining in anything, it is not necessarily a similar situation to what they've got at, let's say, defensive tackle, where they have a bunch of very seasoned vets that will play up front, and they're going to have a bunch of dudes they're going to need to replace at the end of this 2024 season. The quarterback room, I mean, you add Robbie Ashford, I'm aware, but as you pointed out, Lenora Sellers, Dante Reno, it's young. And so, you know, there's a lot of years left in those guys, and there's a lot of time to continue to fill depth there. I'm now with the portal open, Hale, I don't know much about, obviously the portal seasons and stuff have kind of changed over the last, you know, couple of years. They keep kind of screwing around with this thing. Mm-hmm. Are there, is it a heavy quarterback group in the spring portal? And I don't necessarily mean like for like right now, like trying to sign a 2025 guy in April of 24, but I mean, worst case scenario, they got all the way to the end of next spring practice. You know, are there a bunch of quarterbacks that come out of spring ball and decide that they want to go elsewhere? I guess if they were, probably either not very good or buried on the depth chart, probably not starters.
Yeah, I think by and large, that's sort of what it is, JB, or guys who are leaving situations where they weren't going to play a whole lot. And I'm guessing there might be some guys in right now who played a decent amount at the school they're leaving. I don't know. It's not something that I've been following all that closely because I don't think South Carolina is going to try to go get a transfer quarterback here in the next few weeks. I mean, who knows? Maybe that changes because they lose some guys. I don't know if that's going to happen. Circumstances will dictate, but I think just generally speaking, the heavy quarterback class when it comes to the portal is that stuff's typically going to happen in the winter, not the spring.
Hale McGranahan joining us. It's 11:15 here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston. I was looking over the VIP room last night. It's must read stuff for Gamecock fans. If you're not a subscriber to the Big Spur, it's probably a good time to do so with everything that's going on. You mentioned I think we're all pretty much aware, Hale, that as the portal opens now and all the spring games start getting wrapped up at programs across the country, we'll begin to see new names emerge in this sucker. You mentioned we know that they're going to be going after wide receivers. You had mentioned one transfer wide receiver, I believe, in the VIP room last night. Can't remember his name. Could you tell us and give us some background on this young man?
Yeah, Keandre Lambert Smith, who's leaving Penn State. He's a grad transfer, 1 year to play. Led the Nittany Lions in receptions and I think yards, and was like second in touchdown catches last year.
Whoa.
6'1", 205 pounds, whatever. He's from same high school as Fred Johnson in Norfolk, Virginia, Maury High School.
Okay.
I think he's probably going to have a lot of options, not just South Carolina, but a lot of places from what I understand here and some of the national folks on 24/7 and elsewhere talking about what some of the, you know, bigger name programs are looking for in the portal this spring. There are a lot of people who want some help at wide receiver. So I think it's probably going to be a pretty sizable list of suitors that he's got, and South Carolina will be one of them, and we'll see how far they can get with him.
Also on that note, with the portal opening today, the spring game plays this Saturday. Can transfers visit during the spring game?
Oh yeah, transfers can visit. They can visit today if they want to. It's
okay.
It's why, like, when high school recruits can go on the road and visit, so can transfer guys. So they, for all I know, South Carolina's hosted some transfers already this spring. You know, there have been a few guys who have entered the portal before today that were grad transfers, because grad transfers can do it whenever they want. It's wide open for everybody, transfers, high school guys. Not JUCO yet, but transfers and high school guys.
Definitely. But they have to wait till the portal opens to visit, though, right? Not the grad guys. No, I mean, the underclassmen.
I don't know. That's a good question, because I think I saw – somebody say on Twitter just a little while ago mentioned Caden Proctor, that offensive lineman who went to Alabama, then transferred to Iowa in January and was transferring supposedly back to Alabama. I think he was in Tuscaloosa. I don't know if they had their spring game. I guess they had their spring game last weekend. I think he was spotted at that. So
they did.
Technically probably isn't allowed to talk to the coaches. But
does that matter at Bama?
I don't think it matters anywhere, JB. It's pretty wild, wild west out there. And it's crazy, crazy times.
So I guess what I'm getting at here, Hale, is I don't know the rules. So I'm trying to figure out if there was some strategery on the part of Shane Beamer and his staff to hold the spring game this coming weekend, which I think they're the last spring game being played in the SEC.
Yeah.
Where it clears the door for them to allow for transfers to come through, since the portal is opening 4 days prior to this thing kicking off.
That might have something to do with it. Also, the other side of it that I've kind of thought about myself is, If you don't finish spring practice till almost a week after the portal has been open, maybe that gives you a better chance at keeping some of your guys that you don't want to get in from getting in. Maybe narrows the window a little bit if they want to, you know, finish spring practice or whatever. I don't know. I would guess, knowing how Shane Beamer tends to operate, I would guess that he's was very well aware of the timing of when their spring practice ends and when the portal opens and how to try to make that as copacetic as possible.
I guess not to mention, it's also a big Gamecock weekend. Carolina baseball was out of town this past weekend. Maybe that had something to do with it too. I have no idea. Maybe we're thinking too much into this, but because it is the spring game though, Hale, they will be welcoming a bunch of prospects to town. I know there's a boatload of 25s. I know there's a boatload of 26, obviously, in addition to any transfers that come in. That certainly I can ask you that question, because we don't know the answer until probably, I would imagine, Saturday. But the notables that are on that list, there are some unofficials this weekend. Of course, there are some pretty high profile official visits as well. Who are the officials that you are aware of at this point in time that will be in for the ballgame?
It's just one right now that I'm aware of, David Sanders.
Okay.
He's the only official.
Okay.
I don't think that's going to change.
Okay. What about the linebacker? The Zayden Walker.
Oh, I mean, yeah. I mean, if he comes in, it's an unofficial. He's got an official in June.
Okay. So he'd be an unofficial this weekend, official in June. Mm-hmm. Is he, I guess I had misunderstood something at some point in time. I thought he was expected in this weekend. So we don't know that yet.
He visited. So he visited this past weekend unofficially.
Mm-hmm.
And he might be back this weekend. It's not confirmed yet. And his official visit is scheduled for whenever in June, along with most of the other guys. David Sanders was the only definite one, like I said, officially. And there was a point in time when Ryan Montgomery was going to take his official that weekend, yeah. But that changed. And then obviously yesterday happened. So just David Sanders, as far as I know. And I don't think that's going to change.
Okay. David Sanders is we know his talent. He's probably the best tackle in the country, maybe the best player in the country. Who knows? He's up there. JC has been lukewarm at best on him ending up at the University of South Carolina. What are your thoughts?
I agree. I mean, he's coming off a back-to-back weekends of going to Knoxville, and he's feeling pretty good about Tennessee right now based on the interview he did with our Tennessee 24/7 site. So I think he went so far as to say they lead right now.
Okay.
Clemson's involved, like we've talked about a lot. Alabama's around. I think Ohio State is too. So, when you're talking about schools like that and going head to head with them, it's going to be tough to win on those guys. Maybe Georgia's involved too. I can't remember what his top five or six is exactly.
Okay.
But yeah, those are some heavy hitters.
Hey, they've got him in, and Lonnie Teasley is pretty good when it comes to recruiting offensive linemen. He's proven that. So we'll see. They're going to get their shot this weekend. Back to Walker real quick, and then we'll move on to some other things here. But Zayden Walker, is it viewed as a good thing that he's already been on campus considering coming back? Is he a guy that they – I know he's a guy they like. Is he a guy that they feel pretty good about, better than average? Not so sure. Have you heard
of him? I think they feel pretty good. I mean, he's the brother of Jalua Solomon.
Correct. Yeah.
So there's that connection. He first visited back in November of 2022 for the Tennessee game that year. He saw that.
Good game.
Came back for that following spring game. He was at least one game this past season, I believe. Then again, last Saturday. So. He's been to Columbia a lot. He's very familiar with things. And again, the family connection as well is a feather in South Carolina's cap. But he's from Georgia. Georgia's involved. Miami's been a factor. And I think maybe there's one other school sort of note that's escaping me right now. But yeah, Carolina's very much in the mix for him and a lot of linebackers in 2025. He's definitely not the only one, but they've got a seat at the table. That's for sure.
All right, Hale. Since we last spoke to you, as you pointed out, three commitments have landed. Brian Rowe was the one last Tuesday after we got off the phone. And then he was followed a day after by DeMarcus Leach, the safety out of Abbeville, South Carolina, or as my friend Brandon Newell likes to say, God's country. And then Sumter's Anthony Addison committed, I think it was 4 days ago, back on April the 12th. Give us your thoughts on those three young men.
Yeah, I like Rowe's upside as a receiver because he had a really good junior year. I can't remember the stats exactly, but he was over 1,000 yards, had like 15 touchdown catches. As a sophomore, he had like 30 catches for 300 yards, so certainly nothing eye-popping, but had a big jump that way. You look at him, see him on tape, and you see a guy who's a little skinny, could definitely get in the weight room for sure, but he can run and obviously can jump. If you look at his dunks he posts on Twitter, I mean, they're not just dunks of him messing around at lunchtime or between classes. Like they're in-game dunks for his high school basketball team, and they're impressive. I would guess that he's – probably gotten a little bit more into like off-season type of stuff when it comes to football. That's one thing for people to consider when we're talking about prospects is if it's a guy like Brian Rowe who goes immediately from football to basketball or into track or baseball or whatever the case may be, like they're probably not spending a whole lot of time of just doing football things. So there's some potential for growth with guys like that, and he's certainly one of them. I think he could have another monster season coming up and improve on what he did as a junior. And again, the leaping ability that people kind of laugh when it's combine season and they're like, well, why are these guys doing broad jumps and vertical jumps and all this stuff? Well, it measures explosiveness, explosion. And the higher you jump in the vertical and the longer you jump in a broad jump, whether you're an offensive lineman or a wide receiver, if you hit certain thresholds, that's usually a pretty good indication of that this guy could be super explosive when he's fully developed as a football player. Brian Rowe is one of those. DeMarcus Leach, to me, we have him classified as a safety on 24/7, but I think he could end up playing cornerback. He's like Darius Rush. Rush coming out of high school was small school guy, didn't have a ton of offers, was sort of overlooked, both online and by other schools. Track athlete who does like triple jump, high jump, long jump. I don't think Leach's numbers in those three events are quite what Rush did because Rush was like a state champion at C.E. Murray High School. But Leach is pretty close. And they're both tall, long, wiry, rangy type of guys. I think DeMarcus Leach could end up being, again, like a Darius Rush, that meaning playing cornerback as well in college. I think that's a pretty good comparison. In my eyes, that I just kind of thought up while sitting on the couch watching TV a couple days ago, Anthony Addison is sort of, you know, we talked about him last week with JC, sort of along the lines, athletic or physically, the way he's built is a Brian Thomas Jr. Maybe not quite as thick. Addison 6'3", 210. I think Brian Thomas was around this time probably closer to 225 when he was in high school. But Addison's got really long arms. His wingspan is like 79 inches or something like that. So it's a longer wingspan than what it typically would be for a guy who's 6'3". So he's got some power. He seems to me like he's tough when I watch his highlights. I think he's got a good first step on some of the clips I've seen. Certainly needs to get bigger. If he's 6'3", 210 right now, I'm going to play defensive end, outside linebacker in the SEC. But again, there's some upside there, some things that you can see and possibly project down the road as a guy who could be a contributor at defensive end for Carolina. So I like where this class is at right now, especially with the unnamed commitment right now, who we're still waiting to hear from. Mm-hmm. I think it's a good start for sure. Cause I'm going back to all the way back to Jaden Sellers. People tend to forget about him. He's not just offered and committed because he's Lenore's little brother. That guy can play, and he tore his ACL midway through last season. But he can play too. So it's a nice start for this class.
I'm a big fan of blue collar state football players, and just listening to you and others, it seems like this class is filling up with them quickly, and we'll see where it goes from there. Should we just quick yes or no on this? Should we be on commitment watch this weekend at all for anybody that's in town that you're aware of today?
Possibly. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Good. Keep your eyes tuned to thebigspur.com for more on that. Subscribe today. All right, Hale, as it pertains to the game, we've kind of seen the watering down of spring football games across the country. I mean, Lane Kiffin had a carnival basically at his at Ole Miss. You know, things just aren't what they were. I believe, and I'd be interested to hear, you know, maybe somebody will ask Coach this today in the press conference, how spring has changed as a football coach and what a spring game even is anymore, because you have so many mid-year enrollees from true freshmen transfers, right? And you know, a lot of these guys, especially transfers, Hale, you didn't really evaluate them in the recruiting process. So you only get to evaluate them briefly in the portal, and then when they get on campus after they commit and sign, this is your evaluation period. And it's kind of either a, oh, we did a nice job, or, oh, crap, we sure did miss on this. But this is the only time you're going to get to see them really in a game in your uniform for action before you actually play one. So I would be interested to hear their response to a question like that. I'm winking at somebody that asked the question for us as, you know, how you use spring games now versus how you used them then when you'd have guys who'd be here 2, 3, 4 years. Now you have guys, half your team's brand new. But so what in your mind, I mean, you cover it, you'll be there covering this. Like, what is important to you in the spring game this year from an evaluation standpoint?
Not having your potential starting left tackle get hurt. That we can start there. That happened last year.
Or quarterback, I guess. Yeah. That actually did happen. Yeah.
That's why I said that. Really, yeah. Anybody. I mean, that's
injury free. We'll start there. Yeah.
Kind of cliche to say, but yeah, just keep everybody healthy. That's first and foremost. And maybe that had something to do with Lane Kiffin doing a tug of war between cheerleaders and sororities and not playing actual football.
You know, but like they had a dunk contest, you know, like what if you land and snap your ankle? Like it can happen easier doing that than it can blocking the guy in front of you.
To what you were saying though, a minute ago, JB, I think there is something to be said for trying to get as many opportunities to evaluate your guys who you just brought in, especially from the transfer portal. I mean, even the last few hours seeing names pop up on Twitter, there have been several guys, a couple of whom South Carolina was sort of involved with, who transferred to a school in December or January and are now back in the portal. So I think you really need to try to do your best to figure out what you got and be able to make informed decisions when it comes to your roster. If anything else, it helps your guys know, like, hey, I'm going to play a lot, or man, I'm not really playing a lot. Maybe I need to look elsewhere. So you only get 15 spring practices. And if you want to use one of those 15 to just have a field day, then, you know, by all means do it. You know, Ole Miss might contend for the SEC and college football playoff this year. So maybe it won't mean whole hill of beans or whatever, but South Carolina is certainly not in that position. And they definitely need to develop a lot of guys on this football team and try to get ready for the season.
I know that, once again, my camera is having issues today. I got to figure out how to fix this thing. I'll ask you this question about Lenora Sellers. I was asked this question yesterday, so I'm going to just kind of pass it along to you. What are you most interested in watching from or seeing from him in his first real action as the Gamecocks presumptive starting quarterback?
Decision-making, how quickly he's getting the ball out. Is it going to places where it looks like it's supposed to be on time and accurate? Those are some big things. And we all know he's going to be a good athlete. And if he needs to throw the ball deep down the field, but for me, I just want to see how he manages what's going on around him and if it bothers him at all and getting to the right read and making the right play. I can't imagine it's going to be too complex. Probably not going to be running a lot of plays that we'll be seeing in the fall this season, but I just want to see how he operates within the offense.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, how much work do you think he's going to be able to get, considering that you are first and foremost trying to avoid injury to be able to evaluate much of what's going on with Lenoris right now?
Well, there's also the decision that Beamer's got to make, which he talked about last night when I interviewed him at the Gamecock Club event in Lancaster, is figuring out if they're going to make these quarterbacks live, if they're going to be allowed to be tackled. So that's probably going to have to be something that Beamer's going to have to decide here real soon. Maybe he will have an announcement at 12:30 when he meets with the media for his it's Tuesday press conference, but yeah, you certainly want to keep him and really everyone else at that position as healthy as possible, because it's not like they have a ton of numbers to begin with and not a whole lot of experience behind, really, aside from Robbie Ashford and Luke Doty. And neither one of those guys are probably going to be the starting quarterback. So, so yeah, you want maybe just wrap them up in some bubble paper or bubble wrap and go about it that way.
Yeah. I don't know if I want to see him live. We've seen him live before, even, you know, in spot duty last year. So that's good. It doesn't matter what we see. It matters what we see in the fall. Let's not jeopardize that by having a little fun in the spring.
Yeah, you mentioned Doty. I actually was told last week he's taken more reps at quarterback. I'm not so sure I look very much into that, though, Hale. I know he's always been taking reps at quarterback, but I was told those numbers were increased a little bit last week. Did you hear that or see it or know anything about it?
No, but I'm not surprised that he is. I mean, if Lenore Sellers is the starter and Robbie Ashford is the backup, I would think that Luke Doty is going to be the number three ahead of Dante Reno or Davis Bevel or anyone else for that matter. Mm. So yeah.
Haven't heard one word about Davis Bevel, as a matter of fact. All right, Hale, anything else to pass along before we let you get out of here?
No, just subscribe to the Big Spur, 60% off.
Oh,
right now. Oh, for an annual membership. So I guess I do have a last word.
Is it really?
Yeah, anyone can get one on the cheap right now. Not that it's expensive as it is, but
no, it's $10 a month. I mean, it's the best investment ever if you're a Carolina fan, and you get to go watch all the dudes on the message boards. Yeah, somebody can post a picture of themselves and say, "I'm having a great day. I hope you are too." And then somebody attacks them for no reason at all.
Yes,
happens every day.
That's right.
Amazing. Hale, great stuff, man. Great report. And last night, a great VIP room put together between you and John as well. And we know that it's a busy week for you, so I hope you find some sleep and some good food and the whole nine yards. And we'll see you this weekend, because I know you'll be out there Monday as well for the golf tournament.
That's right. Looking forward to that. And I guess that means there won't be a show next Monday.
There will be. I think JC's going to do it from the course, and but I'll be on the course, so I won't be on Monday.
Okay. Well, if your team somehow makes a bogey next week, JB, you guys have to shotgun beers. That's the rule. So
I know Flint will do that. I don't know. I don't think DeMarco is a big beer shotgunning guy, but I've got DeMarco, so we won't be making any bogeys. Yeah,
yeah. All right. Well. It's a shame he doesn't shotgun beers, because, you know, a big former football player could probably put down some beers, and that's probably entertaining to watch, right? So missed opportunity for the rest of us.
We'll make Flint do it. He'll be fine. Yeah, he can handle it. He can do it for all of us. Hale, thanks for all you do, man. You do a great job. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate y'all.
Thanks,
Hale. Brother. There you go. Hale McGranahan joining us from the McGranahan Studios. Somewhere near us and you. It is 11:41, and we do need to step aside for a timeout. JC will be in here in just a moment. And pretty interesting landing spot for Camila Cardoso last night, by the way, for a couple of reasons. We'll tell you about that. Gamecocks in Charleston tonight to take on their final quad four opponent of the year, the Citadel Bulldogs. And we've got much more on Gamecock football today as we get ready for the spring game coming up this weekend. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
The screen, and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown Brewer, his second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer, turns the corner. Touchdown number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right. You know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer, Ryan Brewer Fence. The website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina. And we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man. The building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Cardoso for three, banks it in! A miracle for the Gamecocks!
Forever part of her legacy here at the University of South Carolina. Camila Cardoso banked it in, went on to win a national championship, and now she is in the WNBA. She was the third overall pick last night in the WNBA draft by the Chicago Sky. Congratulations to Camila Cardoso. She is now teammates with LSU's Angel Reese, which is...
So she won't have to worry about her hair being pulled, except for at practice.
Pretty unbelievable. So they will be playing.
Camila Cardoso finishes her college career with a higher three-point shooting percentage than one Caitlin Clark, as well.
Yeah,
as my dad.
Actually, the highest percentage in the history of the sport.
That's right. That's right. You can't do any better than 1,000.
She's the best three-point shooter ever in college basketball history.
Women's game. That's right. Take that, Caitlin.
That is something. Not shocking that Caitlin Clark went number one, by the way, or that Cameron Brink went number two. I think Cardoso was actually projected to go number four.
So yeah, I saw five, I think, in one draft, like, yesterday as well. I don't even know who put it out, but yeah, 4 and 5 is where I was seeing her. So hey, hats off to her going three. Nice.
WNBA is starting to get like the NBA. They had a Australian, a couple of French girls, and then you had South Carolina, Tennessee, LSU, Ole Miss. So four of the top 12 coming out of the SEC. Isn't that right? Yeah, that's right. Four of the top 12. Yeah. Once again, it's crazy. This league's just, it's unbelievable. So congratulations to her. That is also the 15th. Yeah, it's the 15th player drafted in the Dawn Staley era, 19th all time at South Carolina. And next year, of course, there will be, I mean, the next couple of years, every one of these players is going to go. So Dawn Staley within a year is going to have 20 or more.
It's going to pass Geno numbers.
Yeah. It's pretty. At least one Gamecock has been selected in 8 of the last 10 WNBA drafts, including 11 first round selections. And of course, Asia went number one. And then Aaliyah went number one.
Two number one overalls. Yeah. Two number ones.
Yeah. Man. 17 in last year, 17 and 23, there were three Gamecocks taken in the first 10 picks. So it's kind of surprising to see only one player come off the board, but that's because there was only one player that could go to the draft. Had there been three, they probably would have all gone last night.
Probably would have seen all three of them find a home last night. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah. Just wait till next year. I'm sure there'll be plenty.
The next couple of years is it's going to be something. On the other side of basketball, on the men's side, we are on Cam Scott watch now. And the report that had come out from John Whittle, it was made official yesterday that he has officially been released from his national letter of intent and his NLI. And it, according to John, shouldn't take very long for this thing to wind itself down. There are many, in addition to the local, but many national college basketball recruiting analysts looking at this and predicting that Lamont Paris will be 3-for-3 with the top prospect from the state of South Carolina, basically since his arrival. And when you know, go back to G.G. Jackson, and then, of course, Colin Murray Boyles was the top player in the state, although he left to go to Utah, he's still the top player. And now Cam Scott. That says a lot, doesn't it? Because we've been critical. This whole state has been critical of Gamecock basketball for years, not being able to sign the best players in South Carolina. He's doing it.
Yeah, I think he finally found a coach who's relatable enough and able to put together enough momentum. I mean, as crazy as it sounds, within 2 years to make the program look like more of a destination than a fallback.
Yeah. I think Cam Scott is, I think 24/7's got him right around the top 30. I want to say 34th. Number is ringing a bell for some reason. He's a top 50 player really nationally when it comes to the composite. And, you know, you clearly Coach Paris's team, like we just saw, when you've got experience in the backcourt, that really makes the engine run. Not that they won't return experience, but Michi leaving in the portal, DeLon graduating. I mean, that's going to be difficult to replace. You know, Scott's going to play if he commits to the Gamecocks. There's no question. But having that leadership back there, you won't be able to just replace that. So, my understanding, and again, this is Whittle's reporting too, kind of reiterating what he has said, they are still definitely signing a guard in the portal, and they're looking for a big man in the portal as well. And I think they'll feel pretty confident about where they are once they're able to do that. But Cam Scott, he's a shooter, Phil, and they need shooters. That was the problem.
Mm-hmm.
They hit shots, they win.
Yeah, it was. I mean, they shot better this year than they did the year previous, and we saw the success that they had. Then if you bring that percentage up just a hair more to a bit more consistency, I'm sure you get a little different outcome for the season than you would. I would imagine you're definitely not tied for second in the SEC in that four-way, tie-up that they had. You would have it outright and may have had a different road in Nashville and then again in the tournament.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. They would have certainly beat Georgia. Well, they would have beat Georgia had they hit their free throws too.
Right. Yeah.
And overall hard to complain about this year, man. What a turnaround.
You have to nitpick, really. You do. You know, it was like, well, in this game, you could have done a little bit better, which is nice. Hey, it's not just we've got an entire season to lament and an abysmal body of work here. No, they had a hell of a run. And I look back on it still fondly and always will, because I think this really is, you're going to be able to point back to this 23-24 season and be like, this was a turning point in South Carolina men's basketball.
Yeah, I think it was the start of the foundation that they need to be consistent. I mean, that's been the problem with this program, right? Is consistency. And I mean, they've proven over the years they can win games, but they just haven't been consistent. So I think that this is hopefully the start of that. You have to wonder if it had not gone as well as it did, let's say they made the NIT, what would that mean for Cam Scott? Would he have stuck it out? Did he go through the process and decide, you know, I'm not so sure that I really want to go to Texas now? You know, obviously Chris Beard isn't there. Maybe doesn't have the relationship with the staff that he would like. Maybe it's too far from home. I don't know. But had he still decommitted, and let's say the Gamecocks didn't make the dance, they were just an NIT team or worse, would it be this, what we think it's going to be? Or would he have maybe gone somewhere else? Or did he see the success and say, okay, they're actually pretty good, and this guy's a pretty good coach. He knows what he's doing, and I want to be a part of that. I don't know.
Yeah, hard to say. I mean, fortunately, we don't have to look at it from the lesser perspective. But I think you would. I think what the season did was remove the word cautiously from the optimistic potentially, right? So it was like, if you had made the NIT this year, that would have been a step in the right direction. You'd be cautiously optimistic heading into the next season that we'd be able to mine the portal for the right guys again. But it just looks like, you know, now when Coach Parra spoke to this, that, you know, we get a different perspective heading into this off season for basketball, and that now we are trying to build that foundation and maintain that consistency that he said has been lacking in this program. And he's 100% right. I mean, you're in the Final Four 1 year. You don't sniff the tournament again until you change coaches and you know, 5 years later or six seasons later, find yourself in a position where you're, you know, just even back in the tournament, not even making a run. So, you know, two tournaments in 3 years would be freaking awesome. And yeah. I think that's what, you know, Coach Paris's goals are, especially when you talk to him about being able to maintain the consistency that's been lacking in this program.
Well, and also for him, if he does commit to the Gamecocks, he won't have near the pressure on his shoulders that Gigi had.
Oh, no.
You know, he gets to come in and ease his way in. And, I mean, Gigi Jackson felt like the world was on his shoulders. I think he probably put more on him than the staff was actually asking of him. It's just him as a basketball player. I mean, he's used to being the guy, and he really did everything he could to be the guy, even when at times it was probably a little bit detrimental to the success of the team in whatever game they were playing in. But this kid won't have to do that. You know, he'll be able to come in and be comfortable with a boatload of returners, with the exception of Michi and to the portal. Abrima Dibba, of course, went to the portal as well. And then losing your three seniors like that, he still has a bunch of guys returning that he'll be able to kind of ease on into. So we'll see. It's going to be soon. It won't be very long, so keep your eyes peeled on Cam Scott. All right, it's 11:57. We've still got plenty of baseball and plenty of Gamecock football. Alex Jones will join us a little bit later on after Shane Beamer speaks. We'll recap that and continue to press on towards this weekend's Garnet and Black spring game, 7 o'clock under the lights of Williams-Brice Stadium as part of Big Gamecock Weekend. Hopefully many of you will be in town watching football and baseball and I think track. There's all kinds of stuff going on this weekend. In addition to the Cocky Trot, the movie on Sunday night at Williams-Brice, there's a bunch of stuff to be had. So should be a lot of fun. The rest of the program will be a lot of fun too, and we hope you'll stick with us. Resto Pros of the Midlands presents our coverage of Gamecock baseball. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com, locally owned and operated by a big-time Gamecock fan, Jeff Sturgis. If you've got water damage, fire, wind, hail, you name it, that's who you call. They're the most trusted for a reason, and the insurance process flat out stinks. But these guys can get you through that. They're not just going to clean it up and leave you hanging. They won't do it. They won't do it. That's what they're there for. Resto Pros of the Midlands, RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. The Anthem up next.
Mike here for one of the better dining options in the capital city. You know, when I first moved there, I asked people around the radio station, where are the best wings? Well, the consensus was D's Wings. That was then. Today, they still have the best wings, but it's so much more now in their new location at 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia. Yeah, they get voted the best wings on a routine basis. Yes, they get voted the best sports bar on a routine basis, but they're not just about wings, and really, they're not just a sports bar. It is a family-run local restaurant and bar with 20 TVs and 25 beers on tap. And how about these daily specials? Every Monday night at D's, you've got 75-cent wings from 4 until closing. Tacos on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, 18 wings and a pitcher of beer for $29. You've also got ribs and oyster bucket specials on Thursday. And no matter how big the party is, 20 or more, no problem. Just call ahead of time and they'll take terrific care of you. They'll do takeout as well. And guess what? A human will answer the phone and take the order. Billy and his staff do an outstanding job. Check out D's. 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia.
I said, oh Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in southern soil, are crafted by southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barndo Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company, Gamecock, owned and operated.
When you're a developmental program, which all Group of Five schools are, and you lose a great player, that's going to hit you much harder with that next guy plugging in because he's not there yet. He may be there. He's just not there right now.
I just recently reported about, the heart issue that, ultimately let a Big Ten stop and originally decided not to play football. And we had reported out that story, kind of unearthing that it was because of heart issue, potentially with
is that myocarditis?
Myocarditis.
I still had 10 scholarship offers because Chase would go play baseball and I would get a lion's share of the reps in the spring, and they're like, who's this number 17? He's pretty good.
Listen to these interviews and more on the JC and Morgan podcast by downloading the Chief Sports app. Part of the Chief Sports Network.
We'll be right back.
best barbecue you'll ever have. Billy G's CarolinaBarbecue.com to order your catering for your next event. Billy G's Carolina Barbecue in Columbia. CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com to have the Carolina Gold. And you can get the Sweet Heat. And you can get the Secret Spice Rub all sent to your home. And if you're not a very good cook, it'll make it all taste better. Promise you. Sweet Heat, by the way, is really, really, really delicious on... like if you smoke like chicken, because it's not hot. It's not like spicy or anything like that. But if you like smoke chicken and stuff like, oh man, it is fantastic.
Yeah,
and that rub we put on everything.
Yeah, we used the secret spice on some couple of racks of ribs the other night.
Yeah,
game changer. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It is. It really is, man.
I normally make my own dry rub, but now I'm just gonna, you know, foregrow all that and just use Billy. That way I don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, dude, it is. I mean, it's, that's what I love about their stuff is how flexible it is. Is that a good
versatile
word?
versatile
much better. Yeah, how versatile it is. So thanks to Mr. Bill and his entire team for making our meals pretty spectacular around here. All right, so I just got your text, Phil. We were hoping to get this guy, and we've got him back next week, next Thursday. Daniel Kelly will join us. So that's the – that's the day of the draft.
Yeah, draft day. We get him on draft day.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Perfect.
We'll get his final thoughts before they kick things off.
See if he holds on to his – Rattler projections and
he's got him out as the number one value in the draft.
So that's an interesting word, value.
Yeah.
It didn't say quarterback, says number one value in the draft. I'd love to pick his brain on that. Just this morning, the Jeremy Fowler, senior NFL national reporter for ESPN, gave his tier. His stacked tiers of quarterbacks, and he's got tier one, tier two. So in tier one, he's got Caleb Williams all by himself. He's got Jaden Daniels in tier two alongside Drake May. This is interesting. He's got tier 2.5 is Michigan's JJ McCarthy. And he said that the most frequent scout and executive comp is a mix of Kirk Cousins and Brock Purdy for JJ McCarthy, which is interesting. Michael Penix Jr. is in tier three, according to Fowler, and his comp is Tua Tagovailoa and Jordan Love. He's also got Bo Nix in tier three. And then in tier four, he's got Rattler, and he is in there with Michael Pratt from Tulane, Joe Milton from Tennessee, and then he's got Jordan Travis and Sam Hartman in tier five. Look, all the respect in the world to Jeremy Fowler, but his most frequent scout and exec comps on Rattler, Sam Howell and Will Levis, dude, they're not,
I don't even know if those are comps.
I mean, those aren't, I'm not really where are you getting that from? They're not. I mean, I can understand it a little bit from the arm strength standpoint, but I mean, these are all different quarterbacks. He's got a quote in here from some AFC coach, offensive coach, who said, quote, he can freaking spin it now. One of the best pure throwers in the draft. And he went on to say, or another scout in the AFC went on to say, he grew up over the duration of his career, live arm, tough as blank, starts with an S, ends with an it. Horrible OL play, was getting killed out there last year. So that's not very, if the offensive lineman in South Carolina read that, I mean, I put that on a board in the locker room somewhere. But also, and this is kind of what I would expect to hear after all the interviews, Phil. An AFC exec said, quote, he is said to have matured from the past, and I believe it. He's a super humble kid. We had good information on that, and that came out on the other side of it. The biggest concern might be decision-making from the pocket. You would have liked to have seen more production from him. So, like, that's kind of where I get caught up in some of this, and where I give some credit to Daniel Kelly. Now, again, I don't know that, you know, Daniel Kelly's predictions on Spencer Rattler are pretty outlandish when it comes to most everybody else who has scouted all the quarterbacks that are in this draft. But I will say this for Daniel Kelly, and it's one of the reasons we have him on our show, he sees what we saw. I mean, I'm not so sure how, and again, I don't know, but how NFL executives and coaches and these guys that they're getting on the record, I guess off the record, that are saying he can do all these things athletically, one of the best throwers, humble kid, smart kid, like all the intangibles, all the stuff you want. And then question is decision-making when they sit there and tell you, well, he was sacked over 40 times last year and he played behind an offensive line that was terrible. Well, yeah, I mean, you probably think that he would have had more poor decisions than he did, right? So, that's why it keeps taking me back to it's going to be the right franchise that's like, look, we're going to put the pieces around you. We don't need you to go through all this here. You need to be able to step back and throw the football. And right. If you can do that, we're going to win a bunch of games. And so it just seems like a lot of people are talking out of both sides of their mouth.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, give him the opportunity with a real offensive line and some, you know, decent weapons around him. I mean, the guy can make all the throws, short, intermediate, deep, you know, all those crazy outs, puts the ball right where it's supposed to be, you know, outside of his, you know, I guess physical metrics where he's not as tall as some of the other guys and some of those other things they look for at the scouting level. Somebody's getting a hell of a deal on this guy that I think is going to have a good career in the NFL. I mean, I don't think he'll just be toting clipboards.
No way. No. Yeah. I mean, we've
seen it. He's too talented for that. You know,
too talented. Yeah. There's no doubt about it. It's such an interesting quarterback draft. Look, I hear everybody too on JJ McCarthy. I don't see it. I'm sorry, man. I just don't see it. Like he continues to rise draft boards. There's an NFL exec that said I don't see him getting past five or six, like the fifth or sixth pick in the draft. I don't see it. I mean, I know he's a really good player. I know he's. I'm not saying he's a bad player. That's not what I'm getting at here. Like, that's going to be misconstrued. I don't mean that. But if Rattler's being underhyped, I feel like this kid's being overhyped.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I feel the same way about him, and I feel the same way about Caleb Williams, too. Just overhyped. I don't think they're going to deliver the value at which they'll be drafted.
Yeah. Is there a clear, surefire quarterback answer in this draft? Like, this guy is – can you say about any of these guys, that dude is a dude, doesn't matter where he goes, he's going to be successful?
I don't see it. I don't see anybody that I would be able to push all my chips in on the table and be like, that's the one. You know, I mean, you got some guys who have some – physical potential. You've got, you know, Jaden Daniels being the high athletic upside guy. You know, there's all sorts of different little developmental projects, I think, here that we know that NFL teams are not going to shy away from that because they feel like they can fix it. You know, like, all I need is a couple years with this guy and I can turn him into exactly what we need. But I think it's interesting. I think any of these quarterbacks in this year's draft, say through the first like five or six, you know, guys could have success at the next level, but it's going to be less about them and more about the team around them.
Yeah. I mean, I'm reading up on this column here, and there's just things that just continue to baffle me. I mean, Caleb Williams at number one. First of all, his comp is Aaron Rodgers. And then they go on to say other comps include Pat Mahomes, Russell Wilson, and Kyler Murray. You just listed four totally different quarterbacks. I mean, I could see so Rodgers and Mahomes have some things that they do. You know, they've got some unorthodox type throws and stuff like that from time to time. I get it. But you know, these are totally different quarterbacks. What's more interesting is everybody that has been asked about Caleb Williams outside of the talent. They use terms like rare gifts and he's in his own class. He's a star from a talent standpoint. These are the quotes from the teams who were asked about his interviews. Good, not great. Relatively engaged, not in full-blown interview mode. An AFC exec went on to say Williams' pro day was, quote, just okay. I don't think he's had a great spring. He's still going first. That's a done deal. But while he was a no-brainer 3 months ago, there's at least a conversation now. Even still, he's a smart kid, a good kid. He just knows where he's going. Another scout went on to say, everyone who spends time with him says he's a good kid. The noise on the outside, I just don't think that's him. Well, for all the homework that these guys do, don't you want to know whether that's him or not? I mean, this is a guy, this has come up before that he wants like a share of the franchise and he does, he's disengaged in interviews. Well, how is that going to translate down the road? Is he going to be disengaged in practice because he knows he's the starting quarterback? Like these are all things that have traditionally mattered for players that are going in the first round. It's kind of like the MLB draft. Don't screw up your first round draft pick. You're going to get fired. And so you flip the page and then you go and you see the things that folks say about not just Spencer Rattler, but you know, Drake May. And I give a lot of credit to JJ McCarthy on this, outstanding interviews, very engaged. Obviously he's got something to fight for here. All these guys do. So that would be a red flag to me. If I'm taking a quarterback at number one, and this guy's the most talented quarterback in the draft, but he's just disengaged because he already knows that he knows he's going number one. I don't know that I need that as a leader. I'd rather figure out something different.
Yeah. I mean, wouldn't you want to see that guy like locked in, right? Like trying to get things ahead of time, you know, familiarizing himself with the playbook to whatever extent he could, you know, within or without the bounds of the rules. No, you just see, you know, this immature 20-something year, you know, here having it, living his life and I don't necessarily blame him for that, but it's not the mentality I would think you look for in someone who you're essentially giving all the tools to be the next superstar at the next level. I just don't see him holding up his end of the deal there.
I don't know. I'm not an NFL draft expert, but I'm pretty good at reading people. I know that. And reading between the lines. And this kid is just continued to be questioned about his makeup. And I get it. The first round is all about talent.
Yeah.
But we continuously hear about makeup. That's why they do all these things. He didn't show up and do anything at the combine. He had a poor pro day. He's had poor interviews. And he's just a shoe-in, locked-in, consensus number one draft pick who spent his entire career with Lincoln Riley at two different schools.
Right. Mm. Right. I just don't understand. I think that's the NFL front office and coaching ego, though. It was just like, I can mold that raw talent into what it is that we need without considering, you know, what's between his ears. on a personal level that is going to have effect on his work ethic and things like that, and his mentality. And I mean, it's just, I feel like I've seen Caleb Williams get so frustrated and get so emotionally wrapped up in what he's doing. And until he matures emotionally enough to be able to go beyond that, then it will forever be an impediment to his success.
Yeah. I'm with you. I'm with you. No doubt. All right. It's 12:20. We will step aside for a timeout. When we return, we've got, again, still Alex Jones to get to with plenty of Gamecock football today, but we've got some stuff on South Carolina baseball as well. It's a full boat, and it's Tuesday. Hang tight. Inside the Gamecocks, the show. We'll be right back.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
The season rolls on at Love Chevy, where the inventory is overflowing and the deals are in full bloom. Rev up your season with Love's exclusive specials on Suburbans, Tahoes, Silverados, Trailblazers, and the ever-popular Chevy Trax. They're hard to find. At Love Chevy, get behind the wheel and feel the possibilities. New adventures, new destinations, just you and the open road. Act now for Springtacular Savings at Love Chevrolet. The best selection of new Chevys. The lowest price, guaranteed. The other dealers upsell, overcharge, and will say most anything to get the sale. At Love Chevy, satisfied customers say it all. Things like helpful, knowledgeable, honest, and fun. Your trusted hometown Chevy dealer since 1961. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
That's the power of
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark and go Gamecocks.
Hey Gamecock Nation, my name is Kyle, longtime listener of the show and avid golfer. I wanted to take my game to the next level, but let's face it, golf is a hard game to learn on your own. I heard the ad from McKellar Enterprises and reached out to the owner and former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. In just 2 months of working with Meredith, I shot my lowest round ever and I've never felt more confident in my golf game. So if you're looking to take your game to the next level, go to McKellarEnterprises.org and book your lesson today with former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. Go Gamecocks.
Our coverage of Gamecocks baseball is presented by Resto Pros of the Midlands. On call 24 hours a day and ready to respond to your emergency needs.
Yeah, it's game day for the Gamecocks in the Lowcountry tonight. to take on the Citadel Bulldogs down at the Joe. Tyler Pitcher will get the ball tonight. A reminder, our coverage of Gamecock Baseball is presented by Resto Pros of the Midlands, RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. But Tyler Pitcher will get the start tonight. He was able to close out Saturday's ball game. Connor Comiskey, the senior righty for the Dogs, will be first off the bump for them. 17 and two-thirds, 18 walks, 18 strikeouts. Pitzer, a 3.12 ERA, 38 strikeouts in 26 innings pitched. And this is the final quad four opportunity of the year. So basically the final game of the regular season where South Carolina could take a quote-unquote bad loss, and it really would be a bad loss to a Bulldogs team that's really, really, really struggling at 16 and 18, 0 and 9 in the Southern Conference. It's tough sledding down there right now. I can tell you that. They've had for the last few years, like 1 year, pretty much the whole offense gets hurt for the Gamecocks. And next year, pretty much the whole staff gets hurt. You feel like there's just nobody.
Right.
Combine those two. That's what's going on at the Citadel. I mean, they've got injuries galore, and they don't know what to do. I mean, they don't have the depth, and so they're doing everything that they can to try to, push through it. This is a game South Carolina should probably handle, but I guess we'll have to wait and see. First pitch tonight at 7 o'clock, and then the homestand comes. A reminder too, Carolina this past week going 3-1 against Florida and North Carolina, all on the road. And that's something that just hasn't been said. They went to a neutral site and they won, and they went to Gainesville and they won. 3-1 in that four game stretch away from Founders Park. I did see earlier today, like, there are some midseason projections and things like that that are out that still have the Gamecocks as a two seed. I don't. I've got them as a one seed, probably as the 15 overall, maybe the 16, but they're in there based on their resume. And if they win tonight and they find a way to take the series this weekend against Arkansas, clearly that will just continue to move up. If anybody does have them kind of teeter-tottering as a two seed, they'll be in as a one after this week, maybe if they need another prove-it moment. But they certainly have plenty of quad one opportunities left to continue to move up that chain there. Phil. So, but this is the last. This is like the last game. I know that they still go to Winthrop, and ETSU still comes to town as well. I get it, but this is really the last. This is the only quad four that's left on the schedule. So it's really the last one where you'd shake your head and go, "That is just absolutely terrible." But I think we all expect to see them take care of business.
Yeah. So it's the last quad four on the schedule and the only must win from a seeding standpoint. Like, you don't need to drop this game. Don't mess around with that. Don't end up, falling a couple of places in the RPI, because you're right there on the cusp of being able to play your way into hosting. And you still have in front of you the ability as a club to play your way into a top eight.
Oh, absolutely.
National seed. So it's like, you don't want to put any of that in jeopardy by messing around and not putting your best effort into a game that you could easily look past.
Sure. Yeah, no question. And I don't think they will tonight.
I think it'll be fine. Yeah.
But you're right. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. The bad losses matter in baseball too, especially when you're in a league like the SEC, where you're trying to be one of what I think is going to end up being six teams that get to host in the postseason. And you don't want to be the seventh team. Not the worst thing in the world, but you'd rather be the six, because I'm convinced the SEC is going to get six host sites. So you want to be in that top six somewhere. And they've got so many opportunities.
Four of those weren't top eight. I mean, just the way this league is stacked, I mean, you're going to probably have four top eight seeds come out of this conference.
Yeah, you definitely have three right now.
Yeah.
Arkansas and A&M and Kentucky for sure. Tennessee would probably be a top eight seed as well. If I had to guess today with where they are at 30 and again, if this is all if the season ended today, which it doesn't, but that's how I'm going to play it. So if they basically continue to do what they've done, like they're 10 and 6, quad one, quad two, 30 and 6 overall. The thing about the Vols, though, that kind of hurts them is their non-conference strength of schedule is 141. Hmm. South Carolina's is 79, for instance. And so that will affect them to a degree. Not much, but it'll affect them to a degree. Tennessee's 10 and 5 in the league currently. But I don't know that I would disagree with that. I mean, those four, I think South Carolina would be the fifth or the sixth. And then the other fifth or the sixth at this point in time would be either Vanderbilt or Georgia. Gamecocks, of course, swept the doors earlier in the season. And, you know, Georgia and Vanderbilt haven't played yet. They'll play in early May. So that's a, you know, if both of them kind of continue to do what they're doing, that's going to go a long way there. For Georgia, Georgia's 27-9 and 7-8. They're having a good year. But here's what's up next. So they got Ole Miss coming to town, and this is a huge series for Ole Miss. Huge. Ole Miss is 29th in the RPI. So if they can go to Athens and knock them off and get a couple of wins, and they come out of there, you know, 22 wins on the year. I think they have a midweek, so they have like 23 in that series win. They're moving even more on the right side of the bubble here. So Georgia's got Ole Miss, but then they've got Clemson coming next week to town. And then, dude, they go to College Station. So you're talking about the number one RPI team, the Tigers, will come to Foley Field, and then you'll turn around 2 days later and hit the road for Bluebell Park in College Station against the number one team in the country.
Man.
So you've got four straight games against RPI 1 and 2, mm-hmm. is what I'm saying. So if you're Georgia and you clear the hurdle this weekend with Ole Miss, and then you go 2-2 in that stretch, I mean, see what I'm saying here? So that's where you start to play, like the SEC starts to play their way into seven host sites. If the Gamecocks can win, like Arkansas is not going anywhere. So if the Gamecocks can beat Arkansas this weekend, Arkansas is still a host. South Carolina's a host. Georgia's a host. Vanderbilt's a host. Kentucky's, I mean, it just, they keep adding up and they all play each other, but their resumes are just incredibly good. So there's just so much to be determined, but let's say you play this out, best case, let's play the three scenarios. Carolina loses the next two series. They're not hosting. They'll still be considered in the tournament because if you win a couple of those games, you've got so many quad one wins. Like they're still a two seed.
Yeah.
If you win, if you split, let's say they go, you know, 3-3, split the series. Probably right where they are right now. You win the next two, cemented. Like you're probably up as like a 12 seed or something like that, especially if you win your midweeks, Phil.
Yeah, you go 6-2 over the next 2 weeks, including the midweeks. Yeah. You want to be there. That's where you want to be. You want to win these next two series at home, even though one of them is, you know, against one of the toughest teams in baseball right now. This is a pretty critical 2 weeks here when you look at it that way, JB. I mean, because you can basically solidify yourself as a top 16 seed and host in at least the first round with a good series of successful games over the next 2 weeks. Because I don't think I don't think where the following teams are will let you play yourself out of that, if you get what I'm saying. Like, these are going to be quality opponents coming in, and you're not going to be able to play your way out of that. Now, I mean, lose out, obviously, yes, if you go on some sort of crazy losing streak. But maintain, you know, win at home, don't get swept on the road. If you follow that model, then, yeah, you're playing in Founders when it's warm, which is what your goal is here.
Yeah, today through May 1st, if it's a successful run, Citadel, the six, because there's not a midweek between Arkansas and Kentucky, Citadel, and then those six in East Tennessee State. So you take care of those two midweeks today, and then May 1st, ETSU. And again, best case scenario that they win both series. I'm not saying sweep now. I couldn't even dream that at this point in time. But let's say they win the next two home series, and that they go to 4-2. You add the two midweeks, that gives you six. Okay, that gets you to 31 wins, 13 losses, and it gives you a conference record of 12-9. And those two series against the number two and or number four, number six RPI teams in the country, but number two and three teams ranked in the nation. I mean, like you said, from there, don't get swept at Missouri, don't get swept at Tennessee, and then you've got Winthrop and Georgia, and you know, you really, if you win that series against the Dogs, and that's kind of how it all plays out, you're absolutely well into the top 16. And you're knocking on the door of a top eight. Because remember, you would have how many series you would have won, too. You would have beat Arkansas. You would have beat Kentucky. You would have beat Florida. You would have beat Vanderbilt. And then if you get one more series win and you go 5-5, but the quality of them are all quad one, including a quad one on the road, and you never got swept on the road, that's today's resume for a easy top 16 knocking on the door of a top eight. Now, you go win. Like, let's say they go to Missouri and win the series. I mean, you know, now you're looking at 18 wins in the league and things like that. I mean, it's hot grease.
Handle your business. That's all you got to do. Handle your business for the rest of the month, and then you'll be okay. You'll be all right.
Yeah, it's another pretty crazy week. And when it comes to the midweek stuff in college baseball as well, Coastal Carolina is at 11th ranked North Carolina tonight at 6 o'clock. Third ranked Kentucky is on the road at Louisville. Jim Patterson Stadium will welcome the Wildcats, and they will do their best to not be very kind to them as well. And how about Arkansas hosting Texas Tech tonight too? Kind of strange. Kind of a strange mid-April Power Five game, if you will, out in Fayetteville. And Wake Forest needs to be careful. They're on the road at UNC Wilmington tonight in Durham. That's a 6 o'clock first pitch. And I would say the same thing about Virginia. They're on the road in Norfolk at Harbor Park to take on Old Dominion. Have you ever seen Harbor Park? Have you ever been to Norfolk?
I've been to Norfolk, but I've never been to the baseball stadium. No,
Harbor Park's cool. I mean, it's built right down there. Like when you cut through, what is that? What's the interstate that goes under the tunnel?
Is it 95 through there in Norfolk?
Oh, no.
70-something.
No. It's
Hold on.
Mm-hmm. It goes under the tunnel. So they have the tunnel. You know why they have a tunnel in Norfolk, right? Same thing as the Chesapeake Bay. So the ships could travel.
Right.
Across it.
You
get across the bay.
What, 264, 464, one of those?
That sounds right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds right. It's something like that. And when you come out of the tunnel, you can see the ballpark over there right on the water.
Oh,
it's
I
a
see
neat
that.
Setup.
Yeah, I see that. Nice.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, man. But I'm not. Have you ever driven the Chesapeake Bay Tunnel?
Not driven. I've been in as a passenger. Yes. Very,
but
not,
you've been through it.
Oh yeah, I've been through it. Yeah, yeah. I'm not a big tunnel guy.
No thanks. Yeah,
I'm not.
Anytime we go to Delaware to go see Carrie's family, we have to go through that thing. Dude, I ain't big on that, man.
No.
And like when you come out and you're in the middle of the Chesapeake Bay, but you like land is so far away.
but you're not. There's no land yet.
Dude, right. All I can think about is, oh my God, what if there's a wreck? Like, gosh, right. We're gonna be on top of this bridge, or we're gonna be in this tunnel.
We're gonna be stuck in this tunnel, right?
Yeah, the Atlantic Ocean
stuck in the tunnel.
we're gonna be under the Atlantic Ocean. No, that's almost as bad
for me as like being stuck at the top of a roller coaster, right? Because that for me is probably one of my top five fears is being stuck at the top of a roller coaster and actually having to exit the car and walk down those tiny little stairs that they have. Oh my goodness. It's anxiety inducing. I almost need meds just thinking about it.
Dude. Yeah. No. I mean, even like on like a big Ferris wheel when it's time to get off, you know, and you're in the, what do they call them?
Gondola.
Yeah, the gondola. Right? You're in the gondola that stops at the top of the Ferris wheel, or like,
oh, I don't like that either.
As you're going up,
you know, and you're like,
oh, come on, man. Like, it's like come on. One more half a wheel, dude.
Yeah, that's right. You got to load them while I'm at the top. You got to put them in the next car. Put them in the next.
I took the kids a couple of summers ago to, you ever been to Santa Land in Cherokee?
Yes, ages ago. But yeah, I didn't even know it was still a thing.
Oh, it's still a thing. Yeah, it's the methed out park of the mountains.
You're right.
And the folks that they are very kind, but you know, I'm just not so sure that I would trust a lot of the people pulling the levers on some of those things that have been around what feels like 100 years.
Right.
And I took my kids on the Ferris wheel for the first time there, and there was this. I gotta be kind, Phil. Mm-hmm. This guy who was in one of the gondolas, I don't think that's what they're called there, but he was not small. I mean, he was one of the world's larger humans.
Okay.
And he got stuck trying to get out at the bottom while I'm on the top, and I could look down and see him, and I'm like, dude. Like, I've got a couple of three-year-olds stuck on the top of this thing with me. I'm staring at the top of a tree.
Yeah.
No. All I can think about is the guy that's operating this thing has been smoking, like, Clorox and some sort of carpet cleaner all day.
Yeah, right. Yeah, but if you're lucky, that's all.
And you can't get off of this.
Some sort of household chemistry experiment that he brought with him to work that day.
If I ever get down for this thing, I'll tell you, I'm going to bury this dude. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, it took him 5 minutes. I'm not kidding. I don't know what the issue was. Yeah. And when he got off, he had one of those carts he had to go get on to get around from there.
Right.
I mean, it was blasphemy.
That pedal assist. Well, there were no pedals.
Of course, when I got down, yeah.
Full assist, fully automatic.
Yeah. Mr. No Teeth in charge of the Ferris wheel was, did you have a good time? I'm like, what, sitting at the top of this thing for the last 15 minutes? No, I didn't.
Chilling? No, I did not. Thank you. I'm happy to be off. Yeah. The ride's a lot better now than I'm walking away from it. Yes, thank you.
From here on out, I think we're just going to do the farm animals. We'll just...
That's right. It's petting zoo time.
Yeah, we're gonna go to the petting zoo. Come on, kids, let's get out of here. 11 to watch in the spring game on the offensive side this weekend. Who are the 11 players to watch on the offensive side this weekend for the Gamecocks? That and much more. Hang tight. Inside the Gamecocks, the show will be right back.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to Signarama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
Cold Joe here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasports.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer, go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer, just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
Final segment of the second hour of Inside the Gamecocks, the show, Palm Casual. Man, I tell you, I can't. If you've got an outdoor space, I would not shop. Look, I get it. They partner with us, so we have to promote them. I understand that. But my wife and I have bought multiple sets of outdoor furniture over the years, multiple. From different places, which and there's nothing wrong with these good people, good stuff. There's nothing like Palm Casual. That's why we kind of connected on this deal here. There's just nothing like them. Like if you've got an outdoor space and you need to make it worth it, you want people to be comfortable, but you want to feel good about your investment. There's nowhere like it. They've got everything. And if for some reason they don't, they'll find it, but they're the factory. I mean, they make the stuff, you know, and they send their cushions all over the country. But everything they've got is phenomenal. Dock furniture, deck furniture, whatever you need it to be? Is it just a big like wraparound couch? And like, do you have that space with the fireplace and the TV above it, you know, fancy schmancy, and you need a big old nice couch for it? Do you just need a nice table just to be able to eat on? Things that aren't going to fall apart in the sun. My stuff stays in the sun. I don't have to cover it. It's not going to get sun dried. That's how crazy good this stuff is. Palm Casual is in Bluffton. It's in Myrtle Beach. It's in Somerville, which is less than an hour from Columbia. It's in Mount Pleasant. Well, the traffic is probably more than an hour now, but
yeah.
If you travel the right time of day, you might be able to get there. Palmcasual.com. And if you're not from here and you just need to call them, say, hey, look, this is where I live, but I need some help. They'll help you. I promise you. I promise you that. Palmcasual.com, Gamecock owned and operated. So JC's got 11 to watch in the spring game today. And again, we're expecting JC soon. He's had some things he's had to take care of lately. And we certainly understand. We're going to come back to Sellers. I mean, I'm not so sure that there's a name bigger than that one this weekend. JC's also got Oscar Attaway in there and Jawan Howell, the running back transfer from South Carolina State. Gage Larvidane, Jared Brown, Mazio Bennett, the wide receivers, Torricelli Simpkins, Josiah Thompson, Cason Henry, Big Tree at offensive line, Josh Simon at tight end. And I think he nailed it too, to be quite honest with you. So hats off to Shane Beamer for, and again, we got Alex coming up, so we're going to talk to him about a lot of what Shane has had to say today and kind of peel back the curtain on that a little bit in the 1 o'clock hour. In addition, by the way, some news here that from Shane Beamer just a couple of moments ago that Zabari Sandy will be out with what appears to be a torn ACL. So that really stinks for that young man, a talented kid. But hats off to Coach Beamer for understanding that there is still something you can get out of playing the spring game and treating it like that. And, you know, for years around here, you had the fan base kind of clamoring, like, let's zazz this thing up a little bit, you know, and let's play it at night and let's do all this stuff. Let's make it an event. And the university did that. Not only did they play it at night, they've got Gamecock Park is happening, and you got bands. Patrick usually plays out there, but he's out of town this week, so he can't do it. And they've made it really, really neat. But then also, you know, they do everything they can to treat this thing like a football game, so they can learn at least something about their football team. And you know, one of the things that Shane, he said it last year, and I know that that he's mentioned it again this year, that look, so you will sometimes learn, you'll see something in a kid in a spring game. The light will come on, maybe something they haven't seen in practice for whatever reason. And all of a sudden there's, you know, maybe 30,000, whatever it's going to be on Saturday night, 35,000 folks in the ballpark. And this is the biggest crowd these guys have ever played in front of, especially a young kid. And he goes out there, Phil, and he's running all over the ballpark, and he's making plays, and he's got all kinds of energy, and maybe it's something a little bit different. But see, coaches can take that, and they go, hey, look, you see what you did in front of 30,000 people? I need you to do that Monday through Friday. If you do that Monday through Friday, you're going to be playing in front of 80,000 people, not 30.
Yeah.
And So I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan of that. I think that from that running back group, I'm interested. I can't wait to see Oscar Attaway move around. I've heard a lot of great things about him. I'm looking forward to seeing Jawan Howard. I say his name wrong constantly. I can't figure out why I continue to do that. Jawan Howell.
Howell.
Jawan Howell. Not just his size, Phil, and not just his ability, but his opportunity in Williams-Brice Stadium. He played right down the road. Right down the road.
From Orangeburg, right up the road to Columbia. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, like, do you remember when last year when Mario got in there? Remember the first time we saw Mario in a game?
Yep.
First carry he got. And I was like, holy cow, this guy runs with a purpose. That's
a legit. That's kind of what I've heard about this
kid. I want to see these guys. Like, are they running with a purpose? You can tell that in a spring game. You can see those type things.
Oh yeah, for sure. And it's interesting to see like okay, so I've seen Mazio Bennett play. But it's been against, you know, lesser quality high school opponents, you know, here in the upcountry. So it's like, it's going to be interesting to see him face off against, you know, college level athletes. And same, you know, with the running backs as well. I think that, because like you, I'm really excited about Attaway and Howell. Just with all the hype that they carried in coming in here, and Braswell for that matter. I mean, another year of development for him, I think, mm-hmm. is going to be fun to watch. So feel a lot better about that group and that room coming into the season, but still you just, you know, you want to get that taste, right? That taste of what their potential could be. You're not going to be looking at Saturday's game plans, you know, for the fall and things like that out of this, but being able to get some, you know, full speed film and looks at these guys is going to be it'll be telling for kind of the direction that their summers will go, for sure, from a staff standpoint.
Yeah,
you know, this is your last little chance to see what this guy's commitment is here during the downtime, if you will, and then figure out how much effort you're going to put into him moving forward heading into the season.
Yeah, there's no question. I mean, like, we're not going to see state secrets here. I mean, I think that there's a pretty good feel for Josh Simon and how flexible he's going to be. He's a player that JC has listed to, and I don't disagree with him. I agree with him 100%. I'm not so sure that Josh Simon's going to run out there and be showing you a bunch of routes at the wide receiver position and allow that to be on film. This game will be on TV. And that wouldn't do the Gamecocks any good when it comes to playing in the fall, because he's a guy who's capable of going out and doing that. He's 6'4", 245 pounds. The offensive line, you know, I would say of this entire, I mean, obviously we all want to see the freshman. Kasen Henry is a guy that so many people have been so high on for quite some time. And I have not been, and I have not been, not because I don't think he's a good football player. That has nothing to do with it. The injuries that he has battled, more times than not, it generally tends to not work out for these guys. And I'm very fearful for him that's just going to continue. Like, it's hard to, especially for an offensive line that has had problems. There's no other way to cut that butter. They haven't been very good. I would love to see Kasen Henry be Kasen Henry, the player he's capable of being. So, like, it's kind of, I'm coming off as a jerk, and I apologize to Kasen Henry and his family, because I don't mean it to be that way. I'm just, from a football standpoint, over the years, generally offensive linemen that continuously have had these issues, not only does it slow them down physically, it slows them down mentally, Phil. I mean, they're very fearful that this thing can happen at any point in time. The dude worked his rear end off to get back last year. Major hat tipped him. He goes out there, like, the first play of the season, he goes down. No. So, I don't know. As a fan, look, the coaches aren't going to walk in there and go, yeah, look, Kasen, you know, sure don't hope you get hurt again this year. Like, nobody's going to say anything like that.
No,
but like, they've got to be preparing. Like, he's just not going to be the guy that they hoped he would be, and then be pleasantly surprised if he is. And I'm not, I really want to see him. I'm sure they're going to be careful with him though. I mean, if he can go down in the first play of the game of the season, I would imagine it could happen again in the spring game, like it did to Jalen Nichols. So I don't know how much we'll see him and how much we'll see him do, and the whole nine yards. Like, what do you do there? I mean, is it pedal to the metal? Hey, look, he needs to play. He needs this pressure. He needs a defensive end to cut right by him, and he needs to get back in the game. This is going to help him get better. Or is it like, you know, we got to be extra careful with this kid? I don't know.
I'm not sure either. I mean, you know, I feel like you err on the side of caution with some of these guys with injury, especially for, you know, guys who've had repeated injury, just because, you know, I mean, for Kasen Henry specifically, that mental aspect, like, he could be, the doctors could have told him, you are better than you were heading into last season right now. You are in top physical form. There is zero lingering issues with the injury. And there's still going to be that mental side of him inside of his head that's going to be the biggest hurdle to get over for him. Even if, you know, the best medical professionals in the world are telling him that everything's fine, he's better than he ever was, how he handles that first mental rep, and you can tell, you see it with running backs when they come back from ACLs, they get a little tentative and they're not cutting as hard as they used to, even though they're back 100% full strength. There's always that mental aspect of it that is going to be lingering. And I mean, another 3 months might be good on the mind, you know. Yeah. I mean, even if he is ready to go full speed Saturday, if another couple 3 months and then fall practice is what he needs to be mentally ready, I would rather see him then than catch a tiny glimpse of him now that you know is going to be insignificant as they go through summer workout.
I feel for him, there's no question.
Yeah, man.
He needs to play because they have a bunch of guys now, but I just don't know what that's going to look like. I guess we will
Yeah, I mean,
I guess we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. I still that Nichols injury from last year is still right in the forefront of my head as we head into this weekend.
Those things,
and I'm like,
they haunt you.
Just don't play anybody. Let's just have a dunk contest and squirt water guns and turn it into glorified field day. Fire up the light show and let's let everybody go home without injury.
Yeah. Yeah, they haunt you. There's no doubt. There's a name that's not on JC's list, though. It's on my list. I'll tell you who that is when we get back. Alex Jones ahead to recap Shane Beamer's press conference and more. Final hour inside the Gamecocks, the show coming up.
We have started in 1979. Because we're a manufacturer, we're able to control our costs. That's why we like to manufacture as much of the product as we can, because in our factory stores, we can offer a competitive edge over other people around the country. When people come into one of our Palm Casuals, it's like they're buying their car at Detroit. They're going right to the factory and buying their car.
30-day money-back guarantee. That's a big deal with us. I mean, we get 30 days to do anything. I mean, return it, change it, get a different color, get your money back.
When you pull into a store and it says Palm Casual, you know you're at a factory store.
Rescues and Resin, proud supporters of Carolina Rise. They are also proud partners of the show. They make products you can't get anywhere else. Custom designed wood and resin products that make your tailgate, make your home, or make anything stand out. Order a custom cutting board, coasters, wall art, tables, and more. Contact Dustin and Tabitha at rescuesandresin.com today. rescuesandresin.com and put your imagination to work. Rescues and Resin, proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Hey Gamecock fans, Mike Morgan here. During my time in Columbia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington in the Target Center and one in West Columbia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online, or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams-Brice Stadium in the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arena. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
It's 2024 and it's time to get in shape. Charleston Fitness Equipment can help you do just that in Mount Pleasant. The Wilkins family, big Gamecock fans and proud supporters of Carolina Rise and our programming.
on the Chiefs Sports Network. But most importantly, proud supporters of you getting healthy and staying healthy. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Find them on the Chiefs Sports app and in Mount Pleasant. Happy New Year.
With a little love and some tenderness, we'll walk upon the water, we'll rise above the mist. With a little peace and some harmony, we'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand. 'Cause I got him for you.
It is the final hour inside the Gamecocks, the show powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston, electricbikescharleston.com. Get outside with Electric Bikes of Charleston. Phil and JB, Alex coming soon. Guess JC, we hadn't heard from him, but he's supposed to be here. Gamecock Traditions is where you can get dressed for the game this weekend and every day. I know some of you, y'all wear something Carolina every day. Why not mix it up a little bit? Head to GamecockTraditions.com or go see them. Lexington, Village at Sand Hill. Like, if you're headed to Columbia this weekend, guys, make sure you make some time to go by Gamecock Traditions. Gamecock Park won't open until 2:30. So if you've got time before that, head that way. Carolina baseball will play at 3, so maybe many of you are going to watch the baseball game and then go over and watch the football game. That sounds like a lovely day to me, to be quite honest with you. But Gamecock Traditions got you covered head to toe. Carolina baseball, all the national championship gear, the 30-ounce Yetis that you can fit 30 ounces of bourbon in, and, of course, Carolina football and beyond. So Trevon Baugh, Phil, he not one of, according to JC, his column, 11 to watch, and I – we certainly will ask him about it. It's more so, I think, because he doesn't have a bunch of questions about Trevon Baugh. Not because he doesn't think he's an important football player to this team. But he's on my list of guys that I am looking forward to seeing this weekend, as is Kamar Bell, the transfer from FAU. See, last year we saw some transfer linemen that, outside of Nick Gargiulo, who ended up starting the entire year, you know, there wasn't a lot of success, I guess, from that group overall.
That's fair.
I think, I mean, like I can really put the, like, honestly, Phil, we really could put the entire offensive line just into the category. We just want to see them. You know, what do they look like? Are they confused? Do they know what they're doing? But I just continue to have this feel. And again, this is based on information and hunch. I try to lean more on the side of information, that Trevon Baugh is going to be the guy up front. Like, he's going to be kind of the dude that 2-3 games in, you're going, yeah, he's an immovable object up there. He's 6'4", he's 330 pounds. He's built like a beast, but he's got that mean streak offensive line type personality that you want to see these guys have. And again, I go off of information more so than feel and message board chatter and Twitter. You know, I just use the eyeballs. What do you think? You know more than all of us. You tell me.
That's right.
I would like to see Trevon Ball, and I can probably leave it at that, and the rest of you can read between the lines. Very excited about this kid and think he's got the potential to – I mean, Vershawn Lee is the perceived leader of the group, and he should be. But when you mix in the talent, I think Trevon Ball is right there, man.
Well, I think – and that's what, you know, we were excited about in these past two recruiting cycles is the talent and physical attributes for the offensive line. I mean, you know, this wall of Carolina is something that is exciting because you know that we, you know, exist in the toughest league in football. It is a line of scrimmage league even still with all the talent and finesse you see at skill positions. It's still whether or not you can beat your man in the trenches. And the prospects of being able to come around and do that at a high level are here at Carolina. And I think we're all, you know, like you said, JB, just kind of excited to see that come to fruition, even if it is just little glimpses of it Saturday, you know, where, man, he just beat the, you know, just completely shut down the D-line coming at it. And you know, and Clint brings up Marquis, because when you were talking about Ball, it was like,
I agree with that.
Think about how a healthy Marquis Anderson last year would even intensify what it is that we're talking, you know, even ramp up, like now you got Anderson, Babalade with Lee, and you know, and then you've brought in transfers to compete for jobs. Although one thing is, has Vershawn Lee, is he going to start at center? Is that what is expected?
I don't know.
Is that what the expectation is?
That's what's expected.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't sure.
That's what's expected, Bill, but that's kind of another question with this. And I don't know what we're going to learn about it because, like, Torricelli Simpkins can easily be the center on this team.
I'm telling you, they brought him into play. That was not just you could tell with his experience and attributes and all of that, that Simpkins was brought in here to start.
Yeah.
Not just compete for a starting job. Obviously, he's going to have to go through that process, but you don't bring a guy like that in without an intention of having him compete through the offseason, get stronger, and start.
No, you don't. And none of us are really going to get a great evaluation from sitting in the stands. I know that they have been working tirelessly to get guys in a position. This guy's here. Let's move him here. Let's bring this guy. Let's see who works and where they work. They cross train anyways. So They're trying to figure out who's better where. And if he's good here, he's going to be good there. So they don't have the answers. We're not going to get the answers. Like there's nobody. When we cut this show, well, I won't be on Monday. But when the show's cut on Monday, none of you are going to be able to sit here and go, well, I really like this guy. You're not going to know what you're talking about because the staff doesn't know. So, like, what you're going to see is not going to be anything of what we possibly could see. I mean, there might be a guy in the same position, but it doesn't mean the guy next to him on either side of him is going to be in that position as well. Like, they're working through all of these scenarios to try to get this thing figured out. And I think you could cut this however you want. Like, yeah, you don't want some big fat blob out there, some big slobby dude. But almost any way that you cut this, like let's say that in some way, shape, or form, and these would be my five if I had leaders in the clubhouse to start: Marquis Anderson, Vershawn Lee, Torricelli Simpkins, Tree Babalade, and Trevon Baugh would be the five guys that I would have circled today. Yeah. As far as like when they Old Dominion's coming, it's August, it's August 20th. Got to kind of wind this thing down here. We've only got a few days of camp left, and we got to. Those are the five that on April the 16th, I would circle and say, I'd say there's a pretty good chance those five are probably going to be starting. No. And when you look at those five, again, I don't because you might have a big old dude who just can't move around. I mean, that, but we've also seen some. Does anybody remember who started right tackle last year? I mean, Tyshawn?
What game?
No, I mean, put it this way. This time last year, we went to an NIL event, and I didn't know that that was Tyshawn Wanamaker. I thought it was some transfer that we had in, and I'm sitting here, I'm holding my sheet of paper going, all right, well, let's see. Juju's here.
Well, he's tall. And,
let's see. this Ja'Kai's here. And let's see. Now that's Trey Knox. Okay, so who the hell is this guy? You know, and I felt like I knew everybody. That was Tyshawn Wanamaker. And he had lost, I don't know what he had lost, but he didn't look like an offensive lineman. And then he runs out there, he's starting in the SEC, and we get sacked the first game. And I looked at Darren, who I was sitting with, and I said, I could probably tell you why. Because we've got a we've got an undersized kicker playing right tackle right now.
Yep.
I mean, and right. So coming back to the point here, we'll start to wind down so we can get Alex in on time here. But you look at the size, 3'6", 5", 330. Vershawn, 6'4", 320. But he was above that. I think that was before they went through a lot of the weightlifting stuff. So 6'5", 325, 6'4", 325. Marquis, 6'4", 325. You go to Trevon Ball, 6'4", 330 pounds. Torricelli Simpkins, 6'5", 315. Like that looks and feels like an SEC offensive line all of a sudden. Not 6'2", 300. Not 6'3", 295, you know, and I don't mean that disrespectful. And it's not all about just being the biggest guys on the field. They could go out and recruit 6'7", 400 pounders and put the largest offensive line ever known to man. I can't block anybody. I get it. It's not strictly that, Phil, but having talent and having some sort of size and having some sort of like mean personality up there does kind of matter. Sometimes you got to feel like maybe they look like a good group. Like when that group trotted on the field last week, I never felt like, yeah, they look like a good group. It just didn't feel like that.
Right.
These guys all being in the program, fifth year transfer, if those are the starting five, when they jog on the field, they're going to look like an offensive line if that's them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, and that's what you've done in these, you know, past two recruiting cycles and in the transfer portal is, assemble a group of guys that looks like they belong on the field in this conference. You've been going with more, you know, I guess athletic is what they were shooting for with the smaller guys. But I mean, granted, I didn't play this position. Strickland would probably be the better one to ask. But I think what you're looking for is that balance between athleticism, strength, and just nasty. Because yeah. You got to have some nasty in you to play on the O-line.
Yeah. Yep. There's no doubt. There's no doubt about that. So we'll see. But I don't know. I wouldn't take much out of who the starting five are going to be this weekend, Phil. And
no.
I'm just anxious to see the development of guys like Trevon Ball and Big Tree Babalade. And yeah, can't wait to see the freshmen too. Can't wait to see them. We want to see them in uniform and what they look like, but they're still freshmen, and hopefully we'll remind ourselves of that. What was it? Saunders said he didn't agree with me on how Beamer said that. Beamer said Saunders says, I'm sorry, I'm screwing this all up, Saunders. My bad, brother. Beamer expressly said they're not going to put guys next to each other that haven't played next to each other during spring practice. Well, they have been, so I don't know what else to tell you, but I know that they have been. So,
yeah, and we don't know who all's been playing where.
Yeah,
when you're being right honest about it, nobody's been able to see who's been playing where.
yeah, it's that's for sure. All right, it's it's one, what time is it? 1:17 here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Yep. And it is time to step aside. Alex Jones covered the press conference today, and we've got him next. Hang tight. We'll be right back.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And Chicken Cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
Welcome to Palm Casual Patio Furniture. Because we are the factory, Palm Casual has the ability to offer the highest quality outdoor furniture paired with world-class service. Since 1979, our factory showrooms have done our best to make the buying process as easy as possible for our customers. Our understanding of the many factors that go into your decision has helped us create our 30-day trial period that increases the level of comfort our customers feel during the shopping experience. Visit us in Somerville, Mount Pleasant, Myrtle Beach, and Bluffton, and online at palmcasual.com for our products and out-of-state locations. Gamecock owned and operated.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barndo Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned, Gamecock operated.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to Signarama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
It is 1:21. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show. Sonner, I misunderstood what you were saying, dude. So I thought you meant during spring practice. As I was about to say, no, they've all been playing next to each other during spring practice. I know that for a fact. But Alex covered the press conference, so he can reiterate your point here in our Nana's Points chat box about the offensive line. So we'll get to that in just a moment. So I want to make sure you knew that. I hear you. I thought you're referencing practice, not the game. Speaking of Alex, there he is with the big spur, just walking out of the facility, the final press conference before the game is played Saturday night, although they will be live at Backstreets on Thursday for the Shane Beamer call-in show, which is crazy to think we still take calls in 2024, but they do. So he and Todd will be in there doing that. Alex, what's up, brother?
Doing pretty good. How about y'all?
All right, so give us the starting offensive line, starting defensive line, starting linebacker, starting secondary, starting running back, starting wide receivers. Who's the tight end, and who's the kicker? We know who the quarterback is. No, I'm just kidding.
If I tried to do that, it'd probably be completely different come Saturday night.
And it doesn't matter. It's a spring game. It doesn't matter. But what did you learn about Shane and how they do handle the spring game around here, considering there are other programs in the SEC that – kind of turned it into a circus.
Yeah, you know, they're going to do it like they did last year, kind of do the draft on Thursday night, do the player draft. And, you know, he kind of mentioned, like, this is an opportunity for guys to go out there and capitalize off of a strong spring that they had, or either, you know, if they felt like they didn't have a strong spring, they can go and prove a point that night. Because, you know, he mentioned, you know, some guys just go out there when the lights come on, they turn it on. So I think he sees it as an opportunity for these guys to go out there and make a statement for themselves.
Yeah, I think that this conversation, we've just got done having a conversation about the offensive line. I mean, did he talk about those guys today, and what'd he say?
Yeah, he kind of mentioned, you know, they want a little bit of continuity with that on Saturday night. Just, and I think you probably want some guys who've been working beside each other to kind of continue doing that. But yeah. I don't think they're against kind of having a little, you're obviously going to have a little bit of mixing and matching just with two different teams. But, you know, I think you'll see a little bit of continuity there from what, I guess, what we got to see during the media portions of practice. But we'll see on Saturday night.
Yeah. Yeah. Sonny, I never called you an idiot. That's not what I was saying. It was a matter of misunderstanding. Calm down, kiddo. My understanding throughout the spring has been that they have, of course, taken all these guys because they're cross training them and they're trying to see who can do what. You had transfers that came in at the, you know, at the halfway point of the semester, and you had freshmen that came in, Alex, and of course you also had freshmen who played last year like Trevon and Big Tree, and even Jatavius got in there a little bit, and those guys. And so that's it. It's a really unique mesh, you know, when you have players from kind of three different planets all combining and you're trying to figure out what's the best thing for your football team with these guys. So how do they feel about it?
It's interesting. I heard before I got on, I heard y'all talking about Taurus Ellie Simpkins, and Shane Beamer mentioned today, Hale actually asked, like, who are some guys who kind of caught your eye? And Taurus Ellie was one of the first guys he mentioned. And I guess that makes sense. You know, a guy coming from North Carolina Central was, I think, like a third-team All-American there. I think when we were watching them in practice, he was mainly that second center behind Vershawn Lee. But, you know, I don't think we saw Vershawn Lee play some right tackle last year, so I don't think you could ever count out Taurus Ellie Simpkins working his way up into that starting five.
You know, when he came in, we were talking to John Strickland, and he was talking to Cedric, who was Torricelli's coach at Central, Cedric Williams, who played for the Gamecocks. And Cedric said, you know, this cat can play, and I've been trying to tell these guys, you want him. And they were on the money. And I talked to a pretty good source not too long ago about him too, on that staff, who kind of, I don't want to say lit up, that sounds dramatic, but I said, well, how's the Simpkins kid? And he said, he's a football player. And I said, so he can help. He said, oh, he's going to help. And so but where? I mean, is Vershawn played center? Torricelli is a center? I mean, when they run out on Saturday night, do you think he runs out at center? And Vershawn, I mean, what are we doing?
I would guess that Vershawn Lee runs out first at that center spot. But when you look at Vershawn Lee's career, he's played, you know, I think last year, those last five games, the last four games, he played some right tackle. And, you know, he's also got some left guard experience too. I think 16 games at left guard. So, you know, come Saturday night, the offensive line we see may not be, there may be some different pieces come August during preseason camp. But, you know, Taurus Ellie Simpkins is a guy who seems to be catching a lot of people's attention. And, you know, we may see what he can do on Saturday night, and we'll see where he's at come August.
Alex Jones joining us, thebigspur.com. It is 127. He was in there today. Shane Beamer's press conference, the final press conference before the spring game is played on Saturday night at 7 o'clock. How about the linebacker position? It's another group that really kind of had to grow last year. And I know Bam Martin Scott has gotten a ton of attention, but then they also added some big time veterans in the transfer portal. What did he have to say about those guys?
Yeah, linebacker's position, I'm interested to watch in that spring game. It seems like they've taken a pretty big step forward come in the spring. You got Debo Williams coming back, who's a guy who, you know, was right at the top of the tackles in SEC last year. Bam Martin Scott really came on toward the end of the year. And then you got guys like Demetrius Knight coming in, who's long, athletic, fast. And then those two freshmen, J.R. Johnson and the two freshmen, they're really coming on and have been catching people's attention. So that's a group I'll have my eye on just to see how they perform, because I think that group's got a chance to take a step up this coming year.
All right, so Zabari Sandy was the only injury I think that he mentioned today, right, from the scrimmage?
Yeah. Torn ACL.
What else did he say about the scrimmage this past weekend?
Yeah, he said he liked some of the things he saw from it. You know, other than when he said it got about 80 plays in during the scrimmage, he said one thing, kind of going back to the offensive line, he said, I thought we made progress offensively up front. And I thought we had a really good day up front in offense. And just as a team, they got better, he feels like. Mentioned he loved the energy out there, but I think maybe the big thing coming out of that was his comments on how improved he thought the offensive line was in that second scrimmage leading up to the spring game.
Alex, they've got three offensive line coaches. I mean, Greg's off the field, but I mean, he's a hell of an offensive line coach. He's been doing this for over three decades. Lonnie obviously is the young buck, but he's the actual offensive line coach. What have you learned about Coach Elliott and how much he has helped that group in addition to his role as run game coordinator and tight ends coach?
Yeah, he mentioned last week during media availability, you know, like kind of during practice, he's more obviously focused on that tight end room, trying to get them ready to go. But I could see him and kind of, I would imagine in meeting rooms, he said he's always in there kind of helping bounce ideas off of Dowell and, you know, Lonnie Teasley. So I imagine he's pretty involved, especially being the run game coordinator. But, you know, obviously with his experience on the offensive line, that's got to be invaluable to both Lonnie Teasley and Dowell. And it's going to be interesting to see how that group improves here.
Yeah, you know, we're talking about all the players, and rightfully so. I think I'm as interested to watch Dowell Loggins as anything. I mean, look, dude, Alex, Phil, anybody willing to listen? He ain't empty in the – he's not empty in the chamber on Saturday night. It's a spring game. You know, they're gonna get out there and be pretty vanilla. But he's got a different quarterback group now. And Lenoris is the presumptive starter, as we all well know. I would imagine, by the way, all these guys are going to get plenty of snaps, right? I mean, Ashford's going to get plenty of snaps. Lenoris, Bevel, I'm sure is going to get plenty of snaps. I mean, I would think that those top two guys would get the most, right?
Right, right.
Okay. And then the large majority of the snaps at running back are going to go to Howell and Attaway.
Clearly. Correct.
And then a bunch of walk-ons, of course, we'll get their crack at this as well. But I mean, year two as an offensive coordinator in this league with a quarterback with a different skill set, you're bringing in a bunch of transfer wide receivers and a bunch of freshman wide receivers. You're bringing an entirely new group of running backs, and you feel like you've got a beefed up offensive line. And I'm anxious to see what – I mean, Dowell's been calling plays for years. I mean, the guy knows how to call plays. I know that. But calling plays in this league, now that the book is out on him, I mean, he himself is scouted by other coaches across the SEC. They've watched him call 12 games worth of football for South Carolina. So I'm kind of anxious to see what he does and what guys like Sean and Markell and all these new coaches – are bringing in to the locker room and helping kind of formulate this system. Will it look like last year's? How different will it be? All those type things.
Yeah, the one big thing I'll be looking for when Dowell Loggins' offense is how they utilize Lenoris Sellers' legs. Because, I mean, I think last year, you know, Rattler wasn't really that running threat. He could get the first down if he needed to. But this year you got the extra ability of, you know, you got Lenoris' legs. to see what he can do and kind of help spread the defense out. So that's kind of one big thing. And then you got a couple new faces at wide receiver. You got Jared Brown, Gage Larvinane, those guys. We'll see if they end up bringing anybody in spring transfer portal window. But it's going to be a lot of new faces, but it's going to be interesting to see how the offense evolves. You know, you got a lot of those offensive linemen now, second year in login system is going to be big for those guys. So it's going to be interesting to see.
Yeah, it will be. I would venture a guess, and it would probably be a pretty logical one. Like last year, if they couldn't throw the football, you felt like they didn't have a prayer. This team, it's hard to imagine, guys, that this offense is not being built around being able to run the football, right?
Right. I mean, you're going to have Rocket Sanders. You're going to have Oscar Attaway. Like, you got talent in the running back room. Like, I mean, yeah. Add that to Lenorth's legs, and you could have a pretty good run game this year. Like,
yeah. I mean,
you've gone all in on keeping the ball on the ground. I mean, you know, you've done everything you can on the O-line. You brought in a whole new crew of running backs, and you've got, you know, a dual threat quarterback.
Right. Now, look, let's be honest here. Like, this dude can throw the football.
Oh yeah, what tells me is, like, those first few weeks of the season, there's going to be a lot of national pundits who are like, oh wow, that guy really can throw the football. You know, we're just expecting him to run all over the field, and, you know, because, I mean, we've seen him make some throws. I mean, in games, it's going to be one of those, like, Rattler situations where it was like, wow, that guy really is pretty good. It's like, yeah, we've been telling you. He's got what it takes to be great.
Right. I mean, look back to that Furman game and some of those throws he made in that game. Like, I know it wasn't maybe SEC competition, but that throw he made to Tyshawn Russell – on that deep route, and then the throw to Nick Harbor. Like, those are difficult throws, and he made them look pretty easy.
It's not a bad thing in a spring game to put it on tape that this kid can launch it 60, 70 yards down the field and let somebody run underneath it and grab one. I mean, everybody throws football deep. That's not a secret. So I think that's the – if there's any zazz that I'm interested to see from the offense guys – It's like, you know, the pick me up, the crowd pick me up. Okay, everybody gets all fired up. All right, they run out. Woo, okay, spring game, 7 o'clock at night. We've had some drinks. It's cool. Football's back. You know, everybody kind of settles in their seats or looking around. 7:30, kids got to get to bed. And then all of a sudden, you know, oh, yay, because they hit one deep. And I think that that's probably the thing that I'm most looking forward to from, like, an excitement standpoint in this game, because it's not a horrible thing, Phil. It's not a horrible thing, Alex, to have Lenora Sellers drop back and rip one about 60 yards downfield. Put that on tape. They need to know that he can throw the football. I think that would be better for the offense, not worse.
Yeah, I agree. You put that on tape, you got to make people then, you know, people are going to watch, other teams are going to watch some of this spring game, and they see that because they know you're going to have a pretty good run game, or should have a pretty good run game. You put that on tape of Sellers throwing, you know, deep routes, like, they're going to have to account for that come the season.
Yeah, I don't think it's a bad thing at all to have him out there kind of slinging around where he can. That would help the run game. And that was kind of the point of this. Like, I know I said the duh moment of, like, oh, yeah, you think you're going to have to probably run the football this year. Well, no crap. No, you know what? I get that. But it creates a little bit of an oxymoron, because we're sitting here talking about the offensive line and, like, are they going to be any good? Because this team – brought in three running backs that are all pretty good, and we'd really like to see them run. But if they can't run because these guys aren't any good, and this guy, you know, he's not as good as he throws the football. He still is not Spencer Rattler. Nobody is. So is this offense just dead in the water? So, I mean, it really just adds such an incredible dynamic to this conversation. And whatever we see, Alex, you're on the boards every day. It's your job. Whatever we see Saturday night, that crap's going to carry all the way to August, so I hope it's good. Because if not, it's going to be the longest summer ever.
Yeah, yeah. And one other interesting thing I'm watching, kind of talking about deep balls and all that. You got a quarterback battle, a cornerback battle going on the other side of Fortune. So it's going to be interesting to watch those guys go up against either Gage, Larvane, or Jared Brown, or Tyshawn Ross, or any of those guys, and see, you know, if there's any separation in that battle.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Have you learned anything about the kicking game at all?
So we know we knew last week that Alex Herrera had missed a little bit of time with an injury, but has started kicking. But I would imagine he's going to be in line for that spot. He's been here a little couple years, so we'll see where that is come spring game. I mean, obviously we may not see a whole lot of that just with it being a spring game, but I'd imagine he's kind of at the front of the line, but we'll see where that comes August.
What else?
Luke Doty's been taking the primary reps at kicker now, having done absolutely everything else.
It was funny. Last practice we were there, and they normally, one of the first two periods we're there, they normally do kickoff return drills, stuff like that. So I walk over there to see who's back there, and they have the whole edge group back there catching what looked like kickoff returns. And I was just like, what is going on here? But it turns out they're just working on, you know, like, if they're in that second line of guys doing pop-ups. But yeah, Luke, you mentioned that. And Luke Doty has been back there working on a couple catching kickoffs, so he could be in line, but we'll see.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure that there's a kid on this team that I'm more excited to see than Luke Doty. What is there left to say about Luke Doty? He came here. He's done every single thing he has been asked to do. His response to the media about why is he – it sucks you even get that question. Like, I can't even believe we're at a point that we asked that question. And I don't know if it was you that ever asked it. I don't think it was, Alex. But why are you still here? Essentially, it was a question. And he's like, if I was him, I would have wanted to come across the table and slap somebody for asking that, because the kid loves being in school at South Carolina, and his response was brilliant. He said, my parents told me and asked me that, you know, the only thing that they ask of me is that wherever I choose to go to school and play football, that without football, it's still a place I'd want to go to school. And, you know, I had a chance to meet Mr. Bobby a couple of years ago, and came away and quickly understood why Luke Doty is who he is. And so this kid has, hey Luke, run in there and save the game at quarterback. What do you do? You know, he did the best he could. I mean, he wasn't Brett Favre, but he did the best he could. We need you to move to wide receiver. All right. We need you to return kicks. All right. I know I think it was sometime last week, Alex, he was taking more reps actually at quarterback than he had been, at least from what I was told. So if there's anybody that's more of a team player than Luke Doty, I'd love you to find him for me. I don't think that they exist, and I just pray that this kid has an outstanding season.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to find another guy who is more of a team player than Luke Doty. Like, whatever he's asked to do, he does it. And you're right. That his answer to that question was really, really good. Just basically, like you said, saying, you know, if my parents told me if I wasn't going to play football, would I still be here? And his answer was absolutely. I think he just loves it at South Carolina. And as for on the field, you know, have him listed as athlete. So, you know, you can literally do anything on offense. So, I mean, I remember last week he was getting a little bit of reps at quarterback, but you could see him line up at some of that wide receiver stuff he did last year. But, you know, and he mentioned Dekirion Joyner as somebody he looked up to, and that's a perfect role model because of Dekirion kind of doing the exact same thing he did throughout his career. So it's going to be, I'd imagine we'll see him some at wide receiver in the spring game, but he'll do whatever the team needs him to do.
If you go to the roster in GamecocksOnline.com, you can't find his name unless you scroll all the way to the bottom, because as Alex just pointed out, there's one ATH. It's Luke Doty.
Yeah,
he's listed as an athlete. I'm not a big trickeration guy. I don't really get obsessed with those type of things. But if you're planning to put any of that into the arsenal this year, I would imagine Luke Doty's name is somehow going to be involved, because we all know he can throw the football and he can catch the football. And he's probably the most experienced player they have on offense outside of Rashawn Lee. So, you know, we'll see. Final question for you, Alex. The as far as the actual football team goes, the speaking of Luke and the wide receivers, the rest of that group, Larva Dane's name has come up a ton. Jared Brown's name came up last week. I haven't heard much about Amari Huggins Bruce. What, have you heard anything about him?
I think he's been doing pretty well. I think I could be wrong, but he may have missed this last scrimmage. I could be wrong on that. But, he's going to be involved. You know, we'll see where he is at come the fall. But he's going to be involved. He showed he could play last year at Louisville. So we'll see what he could do come the fall.
Okay. All right. Yeah, it's just some of these transfers, their names continue to pop up. He is one that has not. All right. Are you John is headed to Charleston tonight. So you're not headed to Charleston, are you, for the game?
No, he'll be there. Whittle will be there.
Did he freeze?
No.
Oh, there you are. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Got me.
Yep.
Are you, you're not coming to Charleston for the game tonight, are you?
No, Whittle will be there for that.
Yeah. Okay. But, you will be, I would imagine, covering the game on Friday against Arkansas.
I believe Whittle will probably be there for that one too.
I mean, what does John know about baseball? He's not.
Jeez.
Yeah, he's the man to go to for that. That's for sure.
John strikes me as more of a cricket or a croquet guy.
That's right. No, he's a soccer guy. Remember,
he's a soccer guy. Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, he's a sneaky soccer. You don't know that unless you kind of get to know him a little bit. He's a sneaky soccer guy. Now, how about this? Will you be at the golf tournament on Monday?
I will be there.
All right. How about give us a free plug for the golf tournament so we can fill up the rest of these foursomes?
So I will be there. We'll be at the I'm going to butcher the name. I know it's over at Fort Jackson, but we'll be there.
That's fine.
Yeah. We're going to have lunch by Nana's Porch. So it's going to be good. It's going to be a good time being with everybody. I know I'll be in Hale's group for some playing, so should be a good time.
Can't wait. 9:00 shotgun start. Any of you that want to come play, look forward to seeing you. And you won't be out. It's not like we're going to be teeing off at 11:00 where your whole day's wasted. You could get out of there between 1 and 2 o'clock and get home or get on back to work or whatever you need to do. Alex, thanks so much for the report. Great stuff, my man. I know that it's really cranking up. We got the spring game. We've got the portal. We got Carolina baseball. We've got a major basketball commitment that's on watch right now. Got all kinds of stuff going on. So get some sleep when you can.
Appreciate y'all having me on. Y'all have a good one.
Yes, sir. Yeah, you too. Thank you, Alex Jones, with the Big Spur. Good report there following Shane Beamer's press conference today for the spring game. And again, as I pointed out, 6:00 on Thursday evening from Backstreet's Grill in Columbia will be the Shane Beamer call-in show. It's kind of crazy that we still have call-in shows in 2024, Phil.
I know. Well, there's always going to be somebody out there in a fan base with a landline and their radio turned up way too loud.
Oh.
That's going to want to call and talk to the coach and tell him how he doesn't know anything and he should probably try playing this guy or that guy or running this play or that play. I mean, mm-hmm. I love it.
Yeah. You're right. When I was at ESPN, how many calls I'd get from people who wanted to call, you could call in. And I didn't have the greatest screener on the planet, put it that way. But people would call, and how many times I would have to say, you need to turn your radio down. Number one, it is impossible for you to listen to yourself while you're talking.
Right.
You don't realize that yet, but it is. You can't do it.
You're not going to make it through this conversation. Listening to me in your ear and me in your ear. You can't do it.
Trust me. Number two, I can't hear you, and neither can anybody else. So you need to turn your radio down. The feedback has just bursted my eardrums.
I love it.
BRC, between that, we will never make this a call-in show.
No. No.
Ever.
No. No, if there is ever any sort of call-in, it will be a standalone kind of deal, like a post-game, and it may only be
I love you, man.
Chat box no way. Only. Or, yeah, you want to get
absolutely
in here?
Not.
Yeah, get in there on the chat box.
Yeah. That was the thing about ESPN. I mean, because our numbers here are similar to what our numbers were on ESPN. You know, when you add it all up at the end of the day, you're somewhere between 15 and 20,000 a day when you use all the platforms. And you'd forget sometimes when the same people would call over and over, and you get locked into these conversations and you're like, there's 19,999 people who don't want to hear this. You know, like how many times I'd have to say, all right, yep, that sounds good. All right. Okay. And then just talk them off, you know, hang on.
What's funny is you get in there and then it'll be, so you'll hear the guy call in on your show, right? Well, the guy called in on the previous show and he's going to call in on the next show too.
Oh yeah.
And he's going to, you know,
had a lot of that.
And they're just going to rotate through this like cast of characters. And then these guys that call in and women too. I mean, you know, they become like the cast of the show.
That's a fine bomb.
Right. Yeah.
There's a trick to that.
Yep.
There's a trick to that. I don't want to give away Paul's secrets, but there's a trick to how those guys could, you would think a show like that, why are the phone lines not always busy? Well, they are.
Yeah.
But there's a way around it.
I mean, and there's a line that calls out.
Exactly. VRC and Harrison. See, now you guys, y'all can call every day. Clint, you can call every day.
Well, yeah, y'all are. This is the call in. Y'all were in the call in part of our show down there in the NAS Sports chat box.
I agree. Like I would lose. I wouldn't be able to handle how many people just, you know, after one loss want to burn the whole thing down. And
right. Yeah. You see how toxic it gets down there in the sandbox where y'all are playing. And, and so we just choose not to have that on the air.
I'm not dealing with it.
Right. No one deal have with Coach it. Kingston on, you know, later in the week.
Yeah.
Well, Coach,
I think Thursday. I don't know. I need to get with him and figure it out.
Could you imagine? It was like, well, have you found your Ethan Petrie this year from last year? I mean, when are you going to find somebody out there that can hit the damn ball? And then,
son of a bitch.
I mean, yeah, it's like, I don't know why you still got a job.
Actually, I'm gonna see if King will let us cut the calls on for whenever he comes on. Mark, I'm gonna take a call from the audience here. This is
right. Yeah. Could you imagine? Oh, I bet he'd get so mad.
You'd be surprised
saying it. You'll probably just see the red just rise up in his head. It was like, all right, Coach, we got a new segment where we're actually gonna take some calls from the audience. So here we are. Here's Bubba from Latta. He wants to know why you have a TBD in every lineup this year.
why you bunted Casas in the third game of the season?
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Coach, I want to go back to 2019. You got to be kidding me. No, you're out. That was 5 years ago.
You don't have anybody that could be a hundredth of a point better than Will Tippett on defense that we wouldn't have to keep running him out there at ninth hole. I mean, tell you what, know, man. You could just, it's like, yeah.
I'll tell you what, hats off to Tippett for getting going this past weekend.
Talk about, I mean, just being able to compartmentalize and just kind of, because you know he hears all that crap, you know, all these guys who just are like, he can't hit, he's not worth this and that and the other, and he's been struggling. I'm sure he'd admit he's been struggling, but he still goes out there, and it looks like, now he did have a couple of games where it looked like he brought his bat out there on the dirt with him, but this last weekend, much better performance.
Yeah, he was it takes a lot to stay locked in when you struggle like that, because he wasn't having a bad year. He was having an awful year at the plate. Yeah. I mean, that's you know, and then the staff to keep you engaged like that, it's not easy to do. It's just not. I mean, he still struck out a bunch, but he also, I mean, here's the thing, man. If you get four hits a weekend out of Will Tippett, and that rotates that lineup back around to the big boys at the front, you know, you got something working. So you know, credit to him. He's going to see a different beast this weekend with the Razorbacks and their staff, but hopefully he can continue maybe tonight and get some confidence, and we'll see where he goes.
Yeah, man.
But, you know, that's kind of.
He's persevered. I admire that about him. He could have gave up.
Sure. Yeah. You know, there's no question. You know
what I mean? Yeah.
Oh, John said it the other day. Look, he's going to be in the lineup. So those right. that want to just continue to complain about it, there's no point. I mean, he's going to be in the lineup, so might as well stop complaining because he's going to play. You might as well pull for him. That would be my suggestion. Are we out of timeout? We don't need any more timeouts, do we?
We technically had one more to do.
We can run tomorrow. Let's hit one quick more. Yeah, we'll hit one quick more timeout, and then we got a couple things that we'll pass along to you to wrap up with here too. Inside the Gamecocks, the show. We'll be right back.
Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com. A tradition unlike the others.
So he comes over to me and he says, listen to me. I don't want to hear one more word out of you about my refereeing today. You say one more word about my refereeing, then you're going to be thrown out of this game. And so I turned around to all my parents. I go, hey, parents, I'm not allowed to tell the ref how bad he is, so I'm going to need you to do that for me.
Oh.
He said, you're
gone. I'm a beggar who could use some help. I'm a seeker searching for myself. I'm a rolling stone just waiting on a friend. I'm a lover wishing on a star for another, with a broken heart to hold each other close till the end.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style, and seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
All right, it's 1:56, final quick segment of the afternoon here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Over 200 players have already answered. They probably have answered somebody, already entered the transfer portal today, led by the guy that we all know where he's going, Caden Proctor. It's just not official, but he is ESPN's number one player in the spring portal list, the tackle who went to Iowa and then decided he wanted to go back to Alabama. And you know the rest of the story from there. But an interesting tackle is also in the portal, Andrew Chambly from Arkansas, 6'6", 304. He was the second-ranked prospect in the state of Arkansas who also started at left tackle as a redshirt freshman last year, earning freshman all-SEC honors. But remember, the SEC's rule prohibiting players from transferring within conference will actually is a part of this thing. So, you know, we gotta keep an eye on, like, you see big tackle Carolina, if they can find a tackle, they're gonna try to get one if they can find the right guy. And clearly there's some connections here to Arkansas. Everybody probably knows this by now, right? But there is the SEC rule that says you can't just transfer within the league. So we'll have to kind of keep our eyes on that. Other names, though, that are already in the portal that are big-time names are Elijah Herring, the linebacker from Tennessee. Kind of surprising. Jacoby Matthews, defensive back out of Texas A&M. He was also part of that 22 class. Is there anybody left from the 22 class at A&M? The whole group is gone.
That highly touted, you know, costly class. That, yeah, I don't know if anybody's still left. That's an excellent question.
Number eight, according to ESPN, is Keandre Lambert Smith, and that is the wide receiver that Hale mentioned earlier from Penn State, 6'1", 188 pounds, senior. Former ESPN 300 player, top 250 player in the country as well. Lambert Smith had 53 grabs for 673 yards last year in Penn State's offense. It really didn't throw it that well. But Carolina is expected to have multiple conversations with him. So we'll just have to kind of keep an eye on what that looks like. What is John talking about?
What is John talking?
John Whittle on Twitter. I just drove past Palm Island. Isle of Palms, John?
Palm Island.
He must be talking about the Isle of Palms.
Gotta be.
Come on, John.
It was good to know you're down there for the game, John. Hopefully, John, the island was to your left.
Or it's you need 7 o'clock turn around.
Yeah, that's right. On what side of the car did you pass the island?
Furniture. Oh, Palm Casual. Oh,
Palm Casual. Oh, good. Okay, cool. That talk to text just is not working out. No, I'm just kidding.
So he's just entering Somerville. He's just shy of 199, yeah, or he's just past 199.
I don't know if you're going to be on time for the 7 o'clock first pitch, John. John, traffic down there. You may should have left an hour earlier.
Yesterday.
No.
Hopefully, all you can get out to the Joe tonight if you are in the Lowcountry. Gamecocks in town. They're one appearance a year. Hats off to South Carolina for coming down this way every year, unlike another team in the state.
Is that always a home and home? It is, isn't it?
Yeah, they've Coach Tanner, you know, really kind of started this. Chad certainly wanted to continue it, and Mark has wanted to continue it as well. Coming down and playing in a minor league ballpark, playing at the Citadel. So there will be, well, the Citadel always, you know, the cadets always show up for this game. They show up for like one game a year. It's the one they'll show up for. And then Citadel always bring out some more fans, but it'll be about 90% South Carolina fans.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure. But
7 o'clock.
Nonetheless. Yeah. Fun nonetheless.
Yeah. Speaking of fun, thanks to Alex Jones and Hale, yeah, McGranahan for joining us today. A full report on recruiting and on the spring game. Thanks to Mad Dog for being Mad Dog and for being Mad Dog Mustache. And thanks to all of you. Tomorrow's Wednesday. I think we have Derek tomorrow. Maybe Chad. I don't know. Next week is our post-spring football report. We will be joined by a multitude of former Gamecocks, Michael Flint, John Strickland, Perry Orth, Stephen Garcia, a bunch of guys will be on next week to help us wrap spring football for the Gamecocks.
Yeah. Brad Crawford coming in Tuesday and Daniel Kelly talking draft on Thursday. So we're shaping up pretty good for next week.
Yeah, it's going to be a blast. Look forward to that. Enjoy the game tonight, folks. We enjoyed you. We'll see you tomorrow at 11 on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.